Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
My name is Nanette Jacomijn-Snoep and I'm curator here at the Quai Branly Museum and as well as scientific curator of this exhibition, which is called The Invention or the Construction of the Savage. We begin at the end of the 15th century and we end this exhibition in 1958. In the beginning, in this 16th, 17th and 18th century, it's just fascination. There is no hierarchy, there is, well, it's wonder. These are miracles. Eh? They are shown as miracles. In the 19th century, just at the beginning of the 19th century, the division of the other will change. It is the century of the making of racial theorists, and that's you see here when all these people. Exhibits will come here in Paris or in London or in Berlin. Well, then you will have all these scientifics who will be interested in study them, in classify them. And here you see around me, you see all these pictures or malt waxes or this instrument which scientifics used in order to measure the skull of people.
Du début du 19e siècle jusqu'à la fin des années 30.
At the end of the 19th century, you will have thousands and thousands of visitors and also thousands and thousands of exhibits. In zoological gardens, we will build entire villages in order to place there hundreds of exhibits and to show to European visitors how people lived in other countries. But of course, it's a kind of spectacle. They are on stage. It's popular entertainment.
Une certaine manière de se croire supérieur en Occident, et surtout la possibilité aujourd'hui de comprendre comment.
We tried in this exhibition to speak about otherness and how do you create otherness? How do you construct otherness? And otherness you don't build in just in one day. So it's about five centuries of creating otherness, of creating stereotypes. So we are doing kind of archaeology of otherness, of stereotypes.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T Renegade, Justice in for another program, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of racism. Thank you everybody for tuning into the program. Today's date would be Wednesday, January 18th, 2012. So I have been told it is blizzard weather out in the Pacific Northwest. I have not seen this much snow in a long time. Undeterred, the struggle against racism continues. Our guest for today's broadcast, recommended by Pumpkin, she shared information about his book. I had not heard of it before she shared it with me, but I think, or I hope, if this program is constructive, folks will see how this. The same themes, same topics. Number one, we're talking about them all the time, seamless. Some of the same things that we talked about on our most recent broadcast about the Central Park rape case in 1989, themes that we've discussed before around necrophilia, Jeffrey Dahmer, in fact, two of the major themes from our last two broadcasts on the Central Park rape as well as Jeffrey Dahmer. You're going to hear them repeated this program, necrophilia, that's when necrophilia. Our guest, he is a professor in the Department of English at Emory University in Atlanta. Our guest specializes in 19th century American literature and culture with strong interests in the history of medicine, race, disability, popular culture, and environmental issues. We'll be discussing his 2001 publication, The Showman and the Slave, Race, Death, and Memory in Barnum's America. Real pleasure to have him visiting with us for the evening. Our guest again, joining us live from Atlanta, Georgia, Professor Dr. Benjamin Reiss. Dr. Reiss, are you with us?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear. Yes, sir.
Great. Thanks for having me.
Outstanding. Thank you for sharing some of your time with us. For folks out there, if they have not read this book and some of your other articles, could you give them a little background information to kind of help us better understand who you are?
Who I am or what the book's about?
Who you are.
Sure. Well, I'm a professor of English at Emory University, as you said, and I spent a lot of my professional life living back in the 19th century, am sometimes mistaken for a historian because I write a lot about historical issues, particularly as they relate to issues of race and social marginalization. So, in addition to writing this this book, The Showman and the Slave, which we're going to talk about this evening, I've written a book about insane asylums in 19th century American culture. I've written a lot about psychiatric history and the kind of troubling legacy that has in our country, sometimes intersecting with issues of race as well. So those are some of my interests. I've been teaching here at Emory University since 2006. I came here from New Orleans and Tulane University. I left with Katrina and landed here in Atlanta. It's been a pretty happy place for me to land, but I miss New Orleans quite a bit. So here we are. And this book, The Showman and the Slave, as you said, came out in 2001, but it's been reissued in paperback just last year from Harvard University Press, and I'm informed that just this week it came out in an ebook version, so you can get it on your Kindles and other devices.
Wow. Katrina refugee visiting with us this evening. Wow.
Yeah, we don't like the term refugee, you know. That's for folks from other countries. Evacuee.
Right. I respect that. Words are very important. We will discuss that from your book.
Yeah.
Man, underline that big time. Regular theme around issues of racism, terms that are used to describe people. That was a huge part of Hurricane Katrina as well. You are, for folks that haven't seen, you are a white man. Is that correct, Dr. Reiss?
That is correct, yeah.
Okay. This program, The Cows, Context of White Supremacy, I have unfortunately concluded that we are in a global system of racism, white supremacy. I've concluded that those are the best terms to describe what's happening, and the definition that I use for both terms, racism and white supremacy, is as follows. A global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you believe that such a system exists, and do you think that's an accurate definition?
Well, I'm not sure I'd use the same definition, because I think that gives too much power to intention. In other words, I think a lot of racism comes about in ways that people just aren't aware of, or they wouldn't. If you put them to it, they'd say, "Oh no, I'm not a racist. You know, I'm completely colorblind or egalitarian." You know, but then when you push comes to shove, you dig a little deeper and you find that they're part of the system that you describe, and just can't see it or can't acknowledge it. I think that's the harder one to attack. It's relatively easy to, you know, have somebody who stands up in a, you know, with a hood, who, as you say, is consciously dedicated to maintaining white supremacy, and call that person out. It's much harder to take, you know, as I often have to do in some of my classes. You take, you know, bright young kids, not all of them white, but not all of them privileged kids, but many of them white and privileged, and they're well-intentioned and they think well of themselves. And you ask them to look at, you know, what do you have in the world and what are your advantages? And how is the world that you've inherited and that you're a part of and that you may go on to perpetuate, how's that world tilted by racial means? That's the harder one to get at. And that's kind of, you know, those are some of the issues that I sort of try to dig at in my work. So, yeah, I definitely agree that racism is pervasive, that, you know, in a lot of ways the modern world is built on racism. The legacy of colonialism, of slavery, it is, I agree with you in the sense that there's barely a place you can go to on the globe where, you know, racial hierarchies aren't still in play, and where the legacy, the painful legacies of colonialism and slavery aren't still related to those hierarchies.
Okay. I would, again, you are an English professor, doctorate in English, Cal Berkeley. I believe terms very important, as we've already discussed. In my opinion, the system of white supremacy, much more accurate term to describe what's happening worldwide, as you said, as opposed to racial hierarchies or colonialism, really getting to the core of what it's at. I think your book, excellent illustration. I will be using tidbits from it to bolster points that I'll be making in the future. But I think white supremacy, system of white supremacy, I think that's the most accurate term. And I think you can have dedication without, as many of our guests have said, the default right now worldwide is to white supremacy, abuse of dark non-white people. It's to the point where, you know, white people don't even have to be thinking. They don't have to be in the sheet. They don't
That's
have
right.
to have a Ku Klux Klan membership to still perpetuate and practice white supremacy.
Right. I think that's exactly right. It works through people, and what's needed is the conscious effort to stand up to it and to say, you know, I'm not going to go along with it. Because you can let it, for a lot of kids, you know, a lot of young people making their way in the world, they can ride on that legacy. They can surf it like a wave, you know. And it takes a conscious effort to kind of step off and say, you know, I'm not going to do it this way anymore. Or I'm going to look at it. I'm going to look at how did I get here? How did I get what I have? And why do other peoples in the world not have it? And how does what I have relate to other peoples being put down? And that's, you know, that's one of the things I try to do as a teacher, is to call attention to these, you know, to these sort of unspoken legacies that surround us. I mean, I teach in a school that was where the original buildings we have a what's now a second campus, but it was the original campus. You know, the buildings were built by slaves, and that's true of a lot of you know, higher education institutions. Brown University was built by slaves, and the money that came for it was from the slave trade. So, you know, you got a starting point there to kind of look at students, look at the advantages they have, the institutions they inhabit, and educate them about how their privilege is connected to that system.
Right on. I don't want to belabor this too much. I want to
right.
just make two quick points and then hop to the book,
sure.
Which will, some of these same issues will pop up again. Two quick points, the dedication piece, why I feel that's important, very important term, and point out that pattern. Many white guests have been on the program and who have made a very similar claim to what you're saying about the dedication aspect. I would just say there is a long track record worldwide of people making an effort, white and non-white, to point out what you're saying. Hey, let's be conscious. Let's look at how you got that privilege. They pointed out, and the record has shown, a substantial number of white people, perhaps even all, have been totally okay with stomping on non-white people to maintain domination, which you call privilege, over non-white people, number one. And the second point, very interesting metaphor where you said that you're talking about younger white people, some of your students, I suspect, they are comfortable continuing to ride the wave, you said, to surf on their white privilege. I thought that was a fascinating metaphor, which again hits a point that I've raised consistently, that it suggests white people enjoy, get some sort of entertainment, fun out of practicing white supremacy, abusing non-white people. Just two quick points I wanted to throw in.
Well, that's a great segue to my book, because that's what it's all about.
hey, no coincidences. Your book, I really didn't know that much about P.T. Barnum until picking up your book. I guess to start with, can you give us the why? What was your ultimate purpose in writing The Showman and the Slave?
Well, what was my ultimate purpose? I wanted to write a good book. I mean, that's the first purpose. Let me step back for a minute and say, when was I writing it and what was going on in the world at the time that made me turn to this story? I was in grad school, as you said, at UC Berkeley in the early and mid-90s. And there were a lot of crazy things happening in terms of race and popular media during the time that I was there, and several of them had their kind of center in California. There was the Rodney King incident, where Rodney King, African-American motorist, stopped by police and beaten mercilessly. Unlike so many other such incidents, it was caught on camera and made national news, and it sparked a kind of media feeding frenzy. There was the Clarence Thomas hearings for the Supreme Court, and the kind of pitch battle between him and Anita Hill over the charges of sexual impropriety, and again sparked a kind of frenzied media activity. Third one in the mid 90s, as I was really getting going with my research, was the O.J. trial. Started with that, of course, that slow motion chase across the TV screens, where police were stalking his Bronco as it drove down the freeway, and all of these seemed to me to touchstones where they set off antagonisms and conflicts, brought them out into the open in ways that are often kind of suppressed. And they all sparked kind of media feeding frenzy. And so I was interested in how all of that started. How did we get to the point where what seems to be the glue in national conversations are these spectacles involving race and violence and transgression, and where people are kind of called to be spectators or voyeurs on these episodes of racial mess, and I think a lot of that goes back to the very origins of American mass media. P.T. Barnum was the great sort of manipulator of mass culture of his time. He's the most famous American, arguably, of the 19th century. He's known all over the world. And a large part of what he was known for was exhibiting non-white peoples in strange and perplexing situations and stirring controversy, making controversy out of them, and using those controversies in a way to create spectacles that were often covered exhaustively in the mass media of his time, which was the commercial press. So he really, I think he really stands as, if not the origin of what I was seeing in my world around me, but as one point of origin. And the episode that got it all started for him was way back in 1835. It was his first act as a showman. He was a 25-year-old guy, from white guy from Connecticut, and he heard about a performance that was taking place in Philadelphia, an exhibit of an elderly African-American woman who claimed to be the oldest living human, 161 years old, and to have been the nurse of George Washington as a baby. And he thought this was an extraordinary kind of story. So he traveled down to Philadelphia, made an offer, purchased the right to exhibit this woman, whose name was Joice Heth, and took her on the road with him, and eventually turned her into what I think was one of the first mass media celebrities in American history. Now, as you'll know, and I don't know if you want me to kind of zoom ahead with the story, but it has a kind of sensationalistic and very disturbing ending, which I think really was one of the first spectacles of the kind that I saw all around me in the 90s when I was in grad school.
Man, I'm struggling to find the correct term. I hope that was not lost on people. Dr. Reiss saying that what inspired him doing this whole book about P.T. Barnum and Joice Heth, you'll hear more about, you know, this racist arrangement as we go. But, man, to do a book about ostensibly racism in the circus and what inspired that, watching what happened with O.J. Simpson and Rodney King, wow. And Clarence Thomas, can't forget that. It just, wow. It's reminding me of my original statement, white people having fun in the practice of racism, white supremacy, even comparing what happened with O.J. Simpson, Rodney King, and Clarence Thomas to a racial circus of sorts. That is, I hope that is not lost on folks listening in. I guess proceeding with the story, do you want to give us some more? Because I've never heard about this. I'm assuming my listeners are probably, many of them, very ignorant about all this business with P.T. Barnum and Joice Heth. Do you want to continue?
Yeah, sure. So he took her on the road with him, and they started out in New York City, which is where he was living, and he set up shop in a kind of beer garden, a very polite place where you could get beer in the evenings and, you know, tea and lemonade and ice cream during the afternoon. It was for, you know, sort of well-to-do white folks only. It was whites only. Most of the places where she performed were white-only audiences. So you have to remember, and this is the North in the 1830s, and most of the places where she and he traveled together, places that prided themselves on having given up slavery. But here was this white man who legally was the owner of this African-American woman, taking her with him and having her perform for him. He pocketed all the money, it was clear. She had no say in the matter. There was no way she could have, you know, refused to work or set any kind of terms for her labor. She's an old woman. She was blind. She was paralyzed in one arm and both legs. She had probably suffered a stroke at some point. She was emaciated. And he exhibited her essentially as a freak to paying white customers. But there was a twist. And there were a lot of, you know, history of non-white peoples being exhibited as freaks for, you know, the amusement of white folks, both in Europe and in the United States. But the twist here, and what made it a kind of, sensation, was that it was also a kind of history lesson in a weird and warped sort of way. So people would come and look at her and, you know, poke and prod her. You know, they could shake her hands. They often wanted to take her pulse, watch her sleep, watch her eat, things that you would do at a zoo with the animals. But at the same time, she was telling stories about how she brought up little baby George and taught him hymns and songs and changed him and dressed him. And people would often kind of kneel down and pray with her as she led them in hymnal. So there was this kind of double-sided performance where on the one hand she was this sort of animalistic freak that people would come and gape and gawk at and try to touch and poke. And on the other hand, she was telling this very intimate story about how she had brought up the most sacred figure in white folks' national history. And he milked that. And that's what made it a sensation as she traveled up and down the East Coast for months, working 8, 10, 12 hours a day, sometimes 6 days a week, until she died.
Wow. Context of White Supremacy. I wanted you to, because I think this is important, even though this is not necessarily a big part of your book, but you do make mention of P.T. Barnum's influence on minstrel shows, which are exploding in popularity in the 1800s. The book Robert C. Toll, you reference it, Robert C. Toll's Blackening Up, goes into detail about this. Just for our listeners, one, check that book out, Robert C. Toll, Blackening Up. That's on my reading list. Could you share some of that impact that P.T. Barnum had on minstrel shows?
Yeah, sure. Well, he employed some minstrel dancers. And of course, so just to widen the lens here for a minute, so minstrel shows really taken off in the 1830s as a commercial entertainment. And these are, by and large, white folks, although there were some African-Americans who would actually black up their faces and act as if they were white folks, you know, pretending to be black, which is a kind of strange twist. But almost exclusively, white folks using cork and grease to portray themselves as typically either slaves from the plantation or as freed blacks living in the city and mimicking black culture, black dance steps as a way to poke fun, to denigrate, and to raise themselves up above the blackness that they were portraying on the stage. It's a complicated history, though, because, you know, there have been some subsequent scholars after Toll, who wrote a brilliant book about the minstrel show, who've shown that a lot of these early minstrel performers came out of a milieu where actually black and white workers were working together on canals and on the docks and on the railroads, and trading dance steps and songs in ways that weren't so much about, making fun of blackness, but were kind of just in the way, you know, sort of trading or, you know, mixing, a kind of fusion of different cultural styles. But as soon as white businessmen, cultural entrepreneurs, particularly in cities, started to see that this was a popular form, as something they could make money off of, it got turned against black folks. And as I'm sure you and your listeners know, has a long and storied history of promoting ugly racist stereotypes. So P.T. Barnum's influence in all this, he actually had a couple of small episodes in his life where he himself blacked up and joined in some of the minstrel routines, but he employed a couple of white minstrel performers. And back to the Joice Heth story, I think that minstrelsy was one of the contexts that people had for looking at what she was doing. One of the minstrel gags that was so popular during the 19th century was you would have a minstrel figure who would kind of tell a history or a story that all the white folks knew about, whether it would be from a Shakespeare play or something political, and they would get it all wrong. They would make a hash of it, and usually there would be kind of sexual double entendres, and so the joke would be, look, these folks just. Don't get it. They're outside of our story. They're outside of our history. And I think in a way, the Joice Heth story, it had some of those overtones. You know, when she would go and tell these stories about George Washington, she was always coached to say that she had no idea that he actually went on to be president. That, you know, she didn't know why people were making such a big fuss out of her. And I think it had some of that minstrel quality of, like, you know, somebody telling you your history, your story as white folks, but just getting it all wrong and proving herself not to be worthy of the story that she was telling.
Wow. I want to make a quick comment and then go more specific with the Joice Heth and P.T. Barnum aspect in your book. But just so folks don't misunderstand, I think a lot of people, when they think about minstrel shows, they don't get a proper understanding of the significance of these shows. Number one, them being immensely popular, maybe one of the, maybe the most popular form of entertainment in this area of the world in the 1800s, and not realizing what these shows mean in the context of white supremacy, why they're so important, why they're so long running. I would argue Birth of a Nation, D.W. Griffith's film, Total Minstrel Show, and even continuing today, and why you even would say what influenced you writing this book. Modern day minstrel shows and the coverage of the O.J. Simpson trial, the Clarence Thomas trial hearings.
I want to say about that, and you were sorry to interrupt you, but I didn't mean to compare what happened to Rodney King or to O.J. or to any of those stories to a circus. The circus was the media. And I think it's the media, you know, or you could use the minstrelsy as the comparison. I think running a lot of these spectacles as modern day minstrel shows, you're exactly right. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no worries. I think I did say the coverage of those events. I don't think I said the actual events themselves. Certainly not the beating of Rodney King. Certainly not the coverage and the way that these murders in some cases were discussed and talked about. Total, in my opinion, racial theater, a minstrel show. But and these incidents as well, people really do not get the full understanding of what's happening in the greater context. These events are not anomalous with what happened either way with Joice Heth. These are not anomalous episodes. It's not even peculiar to this area of the world. I don't know if you got to hear the sound clip at the beginning, but talking about these same sorts of racial events in Europe with Sarah Baartman, Adabinga. I mean, these long-running, I would argue continuing to this day. Can you kind of put this into a greater global context, why these were so popular worldwide for white people?
Yeah, I think I caught just the very end of the discussion that came before mine. If I'm not mistaken, it's an exhibit in Paris that actually there is a they have some artifacts from the Joice Heth exhibit, if I'm not mistaken. So there's definitely a transatlantic connection here. I mean, I think it really goes back to colonialism. As soon as white folks, first Europeans and then later Americans, are going off to lands populated by folks who don't look like them, with an eye toward conquest, they see these folks as being somehow, you know, open pickings for them to bring back as kind of spoils of conquest. And so certainly the Sarah Baartman story in South Africa, there's a long history of Arabs and North Africans being exhibited in street fairs and parades in England and France and Germany and even as far as some places in Eastern Europe. Going back to the 17th and 18th centuries. So these racialized freak shows or curiosity exhibits go back to the age of empire and colonialism, as far back as the early modern period. and P.T. Barnum walks into it, and he's got that whole repertoire of scenarios to play off in exhibiting Joice Heth. One of the popular exhibits that was sort of competing with the exhibit of Joice Heth was the exhibit of an African-American man who was supposed to have been the nephew or the grandnephew of Sarah Baartman. So he was being taken around Philadelphia, New York, and Boston. They read into the newspapers of the time period. There was another woman, a Chinese woman, who had bound feet, right? And so she was taken on tour around the same time. And in the same newspapers that were advertising Joice Heth, as soon as she left town, next would come this woman, A Fong Moy, with the bound feet, and everybody would get to stare at the feet and touch them and poke them and prod them. No accident, again, that these are, all non-white, performers or call them what you will, who were put on stage working for white folks who found a way to make a buck off them.
Wow. Context of White Supremacy. I think the only two cents I would add in, just the worldwide phenomenon that this was and continues to be, in my opinion, I think it just goes to show that the denigration of black and non-white people, but especially black and darker people, the denigration of dark folks is integral to the practice, maintenance of what you call colonialism, what I call white supremacy. That's all I can conclude from the popularity and widespread nature of these events, white supremacist performances, if you will. I wanted to contrast this. This great information, I didn't know this reading your book. The same time that you have Joice Heth on what's happening with her being displayed in this grotesque manner, you talk about how language started to come up, the language that was used to describe Joice Heth and language that was used to describe black people in general. And I just wanted to read a couple passages from the book and get your comments. This is on page 35, and you're talking about the comparison of Joice Heth to other animals. And you write, to gauge the cultural value of Heth in comparison with some of these other exhibits, it is interesting to note that in 1834, James R. and William Howe of Somers, New York, had an elephant valued at $9,000, a rhinoceros worth $10,000, and a zebra, a Bactrian camel, a gnu, two tigers, and a polar bear, each worth between $2,000 and $3,000, whereas a year later, Barnum paid a mere $1,000 for his year's possession of Heth. Number one, and then the second one, this is on page 84 and 85, and you quote a little
Okay,
bit.
We may be in a different edition here, because I'm not finding that on that page, but that's okay, I remember it.
Oh, okay, I'm not making it up.
Go ahead.
And then this is on 84 and 85. I think I'd have the 2010, the republished.
Okay,
This is 84 and 85 of my edition, and you're quoting a little bit from Frederick Douglass, My Bondage, My Freedom. And you write, this is from his book, many came, no doubt, from curiosity to hear what a Negro could say in his own cause. I was generally introduced as a chattel, a thing, a piece of Southern property, the chairman assuring the audience that it could speak, it could speak. Fugitive slaves at that time were not so plentiful as now. And as a fugitive slave, I had the advantage of being a brand new fact, the first one out. Some of my colored friends in New Bedford thought very badly of my wisdom for thus exposing and degrading myself. The description, this is your work, your words, the description makes Foster sound something like a sideshow barker, and Douglas uses terms characteristic of freak show language to describe his objectification, curiosity, novelty, exposure. It is clear that in some instances, this perception of Douglas as a curiosity was a significant draw for his public appearances. We are so accustomed to mental stupidity and moral dullness in the blacks that an exception surprises and startles us, wrote one witness to a speech Douglas gave in Cincinnati. He is here viewed as a freakish exception to the rule of racial inferiority rather than a representative of his racist potential, akin to a learned pig or dancing bear. I want to keep reading because I thought this was important. This is also about Sojourner Truth, same page. Douglas's was not the only African-American public speaker to fight through a web of images that associated public displays of blackness with freakishness. Jerina Lee had to answer to charges that she was actually a man in disguise, and hostile audiences similarly questioned the sexual identity of black women like African-American preacher Harriet Livermore, the anti-slavery lecturer and poet Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, and the French tragedian Rachel. Evidence of the ritual nature of this charge is the fact that even Joice Heth was described as exhibiting himself by one doubting editor in New York. This charge, which turns outspoken African-American women into bearded ladies, testifies to the intense bodily scrutiny blacks faced on entering the public eye, a scrutiny that would have been unseemly for whites to voice aloud in relation to a proper white speaker. A legendary episode in the career of Sojourner Truth provides perhaps the best-known incident of this sort. Asked to speak at a women's rights convention in Indiana, Truth met the familiar charge that she was actually a man got up in women's clothing. A doctor present then suggested that Truth bare her breast before the assembled audience, and the audience voted in favor of this inspection. As a witness recounted in a letter to William Boyd Garrison, Sojourner told them that her breasts had suckled many a white babe to the exclusion of her own offspring, that some of those white babies had grown to man's estate, that although they had sucked her colored breasts, they were, in her estimation, far more manly than they, her prosecutors, appeared to be, and she quietly asked them that she disrobe her bosom if they, too, wished to suck. In vindication of her truthfulness, she told them that she would show her breast to the whole congregation, that it was not to her shame that she uncovered her breast before them, but to their shame. Really, just incredibly important passages, in my opinion. Thank you for indulging me. Can you kind of comment on this use of language and the disregard for black femininity?
Yeah, well, the disregard for black femininity, I mean, so obviously the first context that we have to think about for that is the slave plantation itself, where black women are considered valuable primarily as breeders. And they, in addition to being, forced to breed with, to breed is the term that the owners used, a humane term, forced to have sex, forced to couple with, people whom they haven't chosen, are also considered fair game for plantation owners and their sons and rowdy nephews who want to have sport with them. And so, you know, the idea of black women as the property, the sexual property of whites, is, I think, behind a lot of this treatment of black women as they come into public on the abolitionist lecture circuit, even in the North. I mean, again, you've got the truly disturbing elements to these kinds of incidents are that they take place in the context of supposedly sympathetic white folks. And this is the hardest part of the story for me to engage and for me to write about, to think about how deep the racism went and the racist assumptions went, so that even the abolitionists who are fighting to end slavery positioning themselves as the friend of black men and black women, would indulge in this kind of, you know, carnivalesque, almost, you know, quasi-pornographic, voyeuristic fascination with black folks when they come before them in the public. It's something that I think cuts really, really deep in our culture. And again, as you indicate, you know, it may be disguised, it may be taking different forms, but it hasn't gone away.
Especially that sexual element, which I think is very important. You write about that when P.T. Barnum, his first kind of written thoughts of his impressions upon seeing Joice Heth, there's a sexual undertone to his commentary in the way that he's describing her body. And I think this is common. I think it's all over what happened with Sarah Baartman, where there all these comments about, oh my gosh, she's grotesque, and this is obviously representative of the inferiority of black people, and these are total degenerates, but at the same time, very sexualized, where, you know, they're putting her in clothing that gives the appearance that she might not have that much on, and you get to poke and prod at her. Can you talk about that undercurrent of sexuality that's, in my opinion, it's very apparent, even when outwardly it would appear that these folks are being debased?
Do you mean particularly in the Joice Heth story, or kind of more generally?
Wow. We can do the Joice Heth, but I think it would be important to touch on how this happens more generally as well.
Yeah, well, I think Sojourner Truth really had, you know, she had the best way of turning the tables on that, which is, you know, you want to kind of, you want to degrade me. You want to turn me into an object, into a sexual object. You want to sort of, you know, snicker and get your rocks off of my being up there in front of you and, you know, kind of toy with me. Well, okay, here it is. Here's my breast. You know, hey, take a good look. That's what you want, isn't it? You know, maybe you suckled on one of these when you were a child. Maybe you're made out of this milk. I mean, it's just a brilliant kind of inversion. You know, and a kind of not just talking back, but, you know, almost a sort of performance art to sort of put the white folks who are degrading her in this way, to put them under the spotlight and say, you know, what's that about? What's that desire about? Why are you doing this to me? What's it really about? And I think that runs through a lot of these stories, the idea that, you know, a black woman is fair game. You know, certainly there are plenty of episodes of this in American history, the most famous of which is, you know, Thomas Jefferson, who can write in the notes on the state of Virginia about, you know, black people being just one half step up the rung from chimpanzees or orangutans. And that, you know, they are, you know, naturally less attractive than white people. And so, of course, it's going to be black men who are interested in white women, when all the while he, of course, is sleeping with Sally Hemings, a black woman who he legally owns. And, you know, I mean, that kind of doubleness, the, you know, this sort of denigration, the, you know, they're lower, they're beneath, but then also this sexual attraction and titillation in the power relationship. You know, I think it's the power that is somehow the turn on, the idea that, like, you know, this is a person, and yet it's somebody who I can treat like an object, and that's what's at play behind all of these episodes.
Wow. But my two-cent response, you were talking about Emory and how some of the structures there were built by slaves. I'm an alumnus, University of Virginia. Thomas Jefferson, they have structures that also were put up by slaves. They even have some markers on the campus where the slave quarters used to be. But one of the things that I wanted to do, hopefully for people who are listening in, who will, if you're thinking, you know, why are they talking, spending all this time talking about P.T. Barnum and stuff that happened 200 years ago, back in the 1800s, I would just fast forward them, right? So if you're looking for examples of this sort of dual racism and debasement coinciding with lust and sexual desire, Thomas Jefferson is a brilliant illustration of this, but I would fast forward them. If you want to go current, I would point at Strom Thurmond, Senator.
Absolutely. Yeah, those are the two great American racial hypocrites, right? You know?
I would just, and I would add to it, to give three more, I would add in this recent, what happened with Michelle Obama, where Representative James Sensenbrenner, I hope I'm saying his name correctly, Sensenbrenner, who just commented about her large posterior. I cannot imagine this sort of thing happening if Michelle Obama is a white woman. I don't ever remember hearing anyone commenting on the rear end of the first lady. I think you even get your chapter, profane and what is it, sacred and profane? Sacred and profane. First lady, she's supposed to be revered, respected, and at the same time being disrespected, shown total disregard, and just... It's Sarah Baartman all over again, I would say, in 2012.
Yeah, so and the reference there is that one of the little nicknames applied to Joice Heth mockingly was that, supposedly she claimed to be the first lady, right? Or that she's sort of positioning herself in that way. And so, right, so maybe this is an origin of that. It's both the exaltation, but then the exaltation turns out to be a form of mockery. And it's connected again to, this sort of sexual possession.
Wow. If I had to throw in two others, I would add, connecting the programs we've been doing, Jeffrey Dahmer, sexual abuse, most of his victims being black males, sexual abuse and killed them. I would say you get them the same thing, the sexual desire and the debasement, killing these victims ultimately. And I would throw in Monster's Ball with Halle Berry, where she gets an Academy Award for a very sexually degrading scene from a racist. He's been calling people nigger and blatantly, Billy Bob Thornton's character in the film, he's been blatantly practicing. He's a corrections officer at a prison, for goodness sake. Kills her husband, and then sexually, I would say it's the exact same thing for anyone looking for these trends continuing. Exact same thing. Is it making sense, Dr. Reiss?
It does, yeah. And one additional one I'd throw in there is probably the Michael Jackson story, where the fascination with his sex life and the sort of glee that met his death, glee in the sense of just a media pile on where they could not stop shoving that story down our throats, and at one moment calling him the king of pop and at the next moment calling him a child rapist. I think it's part of that legacy.
Dedication. I just say the word dedication to white supremacy and the racial circus again. Michael Jackson's entire career, I would say, a total white supremacist circus from beginning to end. And the dehumanization, I would say, it's there as well. I think one of the famous posters, they have him with E.T., where you don't get to be a man, you don't get to be a woman, you're some sort of subhuman alien.
He really identified, I read somewhere, with the Elephant Man,
Wow.
That famous film about the guy with elephantiasis, the abnormally kind of prolonged facial features, who was a very popular exhibit in London in the 19th century. But the interesting thing about Michael Jackson, that complicates it, is one of the other historical figures he really identified with was P.T. Barnum. I don't know whether MJ ever knew the story of Barnum's treatment of Heth or some of the other racially exploitative exhibits that he put on, but I think the part of him that he identified with was that Michael Jackson himself was a showman, and he liked to create and stir up controversy. Now, I think by the end of his life, he was a total victim of that, and he was made a kind of object of somebody else's spectacle rather than the ones he wanted to create. That's the tragic element there. But I think the way that his death played out just really really reminded me of a lot of the things that I had been reading about in the 19th century.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Dr. Benjamin Reiss. Just one point, I want to ask a question, and this goes to specifically the story with Barnum and Heth. Wide speculation, and there were a lot of people who thought, humbug, one of my favorite words, people saying Barnum was making all this up, and they didn't believe the whole story about her being a nanny for George Washington. At her death, her autopsy continues the spectacle, I'll say it that way, continues this white supremacist spectacle. I just brought up Jeffrey Dahmer, and I said that theme necrophilia continues, and you see it with Sarah Baartman as well. For me, it's only a contradiction, the racism and the debasement of black people, and then the lust, Thomas Jefferson, Strom Thurmond. It's only a contradiction if one, in my opinion, if one thinks of that sexual desire in a loving manner. If you think of it more in sex representing domination, think of it in the vein of rape. If you think of it that way, I think it makes total sense with this represents the ultimate form of domination. Can you talk about the necrophilic aspect of the Barnum-Heth relationship and this autopsy that becomes a spectacle?
Yeah, well, you can imagine. You've got a guy touring up and down, making a name for himself, making some money, with a very old, ill woman. By the end of her time, newspapers were always speculating, you know, when is she gonna pass? Talking about her as the last living link to, you know, to George Washington. And you got to think Barnum was calculating. What's going to happen? So she's brought dead in the winter of 1836 up to his doorstep in a carriage. And he sends out word. There had been a lot of speculation about, you know, as you said, was she genuine? Was she telling the truth? Was she really as old as she claimed? Was she really George Washington's nanny? And there had been a lot of doctors and medical men coming to visit her and kind of look at her and, you know, test how brittle are her bones and what's her pulse and, you know, what are her sleeping and eating habits and, you know, what can we deduce about her age from all of this stuff? But, you know, they kept saying, we'll never know till she dies. And so Barnum arranged what was clearly the biggest, most sort of spectacular event, not only through the course of this exhibit, but I think in American history up to that point. It's the first kind of staged media event, which was a public autopsy. He rented out a hall in New York City that could seat a few hundred people, and he charged admission. 25 cents is pretty good money back then. You know, it's probably $15, $20, maybe even a bit more than that today. And he contacted a well-known physician who had an interest in pathological anatomy to come and dissect her. And with hundreds of people and journalists peering on, looking on, he cut her open, and he examined her skeletal structure. He examined the condition of her arteries and her lungs and her heart and even her brain. And at the end of his operation, he concluded that she couldn't possibly have been more than 80 years old and that the whole thing was a hoax. And then the whole thing broke loose. I mean, and then we have OJ and MJ and, you know, the whole circus comes to town, mostly in the form of newspapermen who, you know, the first thing is to get the story first, right? Who's going to get it out there first? And you got these competition between commercial newspapers, first generation of commercially run newspapers, people trying to make a buck by selling the news, which was often, you know, stories like this, sensationalistic stories about hoaxes or famous criminals or prostitutes who are, you know, who are exposed and so on. And so they print the news, front page, you know, sometimes with her picture, which was also new, woodcuts with her likeness. And it's all over the streets of New York, and then Boston, and then Providence, and then every little town you could ever hear of. Well, but then you get another doctor who comes out and says, you know, this first doctor was wrong. You know, she actually, I went up there with him, and I took a look, and he doesn't know what he's talking about, and we have precedent from X, Y, and Z to show that, you know, bones can look like the way he said, and be, you know, people 120, 130 years old. So she could well be in advance of that. And then you have counter charges and, you know, people weighing in from every possible angle. You know, at one point, Barnum weighs in and says, you know, actually, she's not dead at all. This whole thing was a hoax. She's alive and well and living in New Jersey, and she's going to come back. I'm going to take her on tour again, you know. And he's just fanning the flames in every possible way. And what it really, what was really at the center of this was her naked dead body up on an operating table in an auditorium in New York City with hundreds of white folks looking on as she's cut open in the most disrespectful and humiliating way. You got to remember, too, at this time, this was sort of the first period of where, you know, dissections were done as part of medical training. And the problem was always, how are you going to get a corpse, right? Because it was considered an incredible assault on the integrity of the body. And a lot of people believed, you know, that if your body was disfigured in some way, you wouldn't go to heaven. And so the solution to this was to take people who were at the bottom of the social ladder. So you had prostitutes, criminals, and black folks who were essentially stocking the medical cabinets of dissectors through much of the 19th century. Because there was nobody in a position of power who could stick up for them and say, you know, that's our kin, that's our loved one. You can't do that. So, you know, she made money for Barnum in death as she had in life, much more in death than she had in life. And I think that quality, what he was selling at that point, had a lot to do with what you were talking about. The kind of bloodlust for a non-white woman's body lying naked and exposed for all to see on this operating table.
Context of White Supremacy. I will double check to see if Justice has questions. I'll also give out the number as well. I just want to read the definition for necrophilia: a morbid and especially erotic and or sexual attraction towards corpses. Necrophilia. I would say this definitely qualifies. Jeffrey Dahmer, Sarah Baartman again, and they, white people, I would say qualifies. You see that trend continuing. That's why I keep saying dedication, not only in the way she was abused and displayed in these zoos and what have you during her life, but them not releasing her remains and keeping them stored and packed away as some sort of, excuse me, some sort of artifact, and even begrudgingly, finally, sending her remains back to the continent of Africa to be properly buried, begrudgingly. This only happened...
How many years later? 100, 200 almost.
I mean, yeah. Necrophilia, a common thread in white supremacy, the possession, degrading of black bodies in life and death. The number to dial in if you have questions is 760-569-7676. And the code is 560-963. So I'll say the number one more time, 760-569-7676. And the code is 560, excuse me, I think I'm giving out the incorrect code. I can't pull it up on my, okay. The code is 564-943-POUND. Code, again, 564-943-POUND. Justice, if you, well, man, what's going on? I don't see her on the line. Well, as soon as she calls back in, I will open her line up. I'm not seeing her on the line now. I'll ask my next question as I wait to see if she dials in. You already mentioned P.T. Barnum. He participated, purchased slaves. You talk about that in his book. Significant influence on minstrel shows in the 19th century. He even participated. You talked about it. Participated, blackface himself. What exactly would motivate, what would interest white people, massive numbers of white people, what would interest them in seeing a white person pretend to be a black person singing songs for people that they have concluded are ignorant and inferior? Why were so many white people enthralled in this sort of entertainment, racist entertainment?
Well, that's the big question, because as you said, the minstrel shows were the biggest thing going through virtually all, you know, from the 1830s on through pretty much the rest of the 19th century, and certainly in the years leading up to the Civil War. And, you know, what a lot of scholars talk about is the element of class, and that the first big audience for these minstrel productions were working class white folks, particularly young adults, what we would today call teenagers. They didn't have that category back then. But young men on the make in cities. And why would they be interested in watching this stuff? Well, you know, in some way, one of the answers about this is that the audience was made up of people who were on the kind of lower rungs of white society, and they liked having somebody below them to make fun of. You know, you feel good about yourself if you have somebody you can look down on, and you say, well, at least I'm not going to sink that far. And I think that is one of the roles that black folks played in the white psychic imagination in the 19th century. But I would say, pulling against that, you know, it's complicated because minstrelsy is it's the first in a series of entertainment forms that originate out of black culture that are co-opted by whites and then become tremendously successful and, you know, generate a lot of money and a lot of, you know, popular attention once they become either performed by white folks or are safely contained within, you know, white entertainment structures. And, you know, in the early 20th century, we had ragtime. Some of this happened with jazz, although I think jazz managed to retain its kind of integrity as a black art form separate from the white entertainment industry. It certainly happened with rock and roll once Elvis Presley got a hold of, you know, blues riffs and started ripping off R&B songs, you know, becomes a craze for young white kids. And one of the things that I think is behind this story that you can go back to with minstrelsy is a kind of envy. And, you know, Eric Lott wrote a book. It's a very interesting book. I don't agree with every aspect of it, but a book called Love and Theft. The theft part is easy to see, ripping off black dance moves, black songs, etc., black cultural styles. That's the theft part. What's the love part? I would call it almost more something like envy, or, you know, I think part of what role African Americans played in the white psychic imagination in, you know, in popular culture from the 19th century onward is of that group that is paradoxically free of social rules. That, you know, if you're outside of society, if you're beneath civilization, maybe you don't have to play by its rules. And so the kind of sexual dance styles and moves that the minstrel performers, you know, ripped off or turned into this kind of popular form for white folks, it wouldn't be enough to explain it just to say that the white audiences were kind of sneering down and looking down at at black culture. In some ways, they envied it. And I think that's the brilliant part of Eric Lott's analysis of it.
He's a professor at my alma mater, University
that's
of
right.
Virginia.
That's right.
Wow. I see a lot of evidence. I don't know if love is the correct term. That would be the only thing. I don't know if what you're suggesting, envy, perhaps. I don't know, but it reminded me of Neely Fuller Jr. in his book where he says the reason that white people practice racism, white supremacy, is not because they hate black people, but that white people hate black people because white people are not black.
That's a great way of saying it. And that is a kind of envy. It's sort of like, man, I wish I could. And, you know, you think about it in the context of slavery times, to say I wish I could be that free. Well, that's the paradox. Obviously, it's a group that's not free, even if they're, you're talking about, nominally free African Americans living in the North. I mean, not free to go where they please, not free to, enter schools and universities and other public places. But somehow there was something about the cultural style that represented freedom or liberation because it was cast as uncivilized. I think that's the paradox that can go some way, maybe not the whole way, toward explaining the fascination.
Wow. Context of White Supremacy, again, our guest, Dr. Reiss, author of The Showman and the Slave, and other volumes. Folks, if you're interested in dialing in, if you have questions, the number to dial is 760-569-7676, and the code is 564-943-pound. I definitely wanted to make sure I get this in because we speak to a lot of white people on the program about racism, white supremacy. Some of them allege that they are working against racism. Not all, but some of them at least say that they are trying to solve this problem. You have a portion of the book where you talk about P.T. Barnum when he went to Providence. At the time, you do have some white people who say they're against slavery. And that, you know, the so-called abolitionist movement. P.T. Barnum goes to Providence. He's still doing his carnival act, racist minstrel show with Joice Heth. And he says, hey, I will get these folks to help me promote this event so that I can make some money by trying to convince them that this is in line with their abolitionist thinking. Can you talk about that, how he really, in my opinion, practiced racism, white supremacy to pretend that he was against slavery?
Yeah, I mean, this is the dizzying part of it, unpeeling the layers of deception and posing, posturing that were going on. It's part of what made Barnum Barnum. It's why people were interested in him, why he was so famous, because he perfected this act where he would, whatever controversy could be stirred up, he would flip it. And then flip it again, and then flip it again, until you didn't know which way your head was spinning. All fun and so on, until you realize there are human beings at the center of this, and sometimes they're being flipped too. Well, what happened in Providence, as you said, there's a group of abolitionist ministers who take objection to this exhibit, and as far as I know, it's the only recorded kind of protest against it during the time. And they said, you know, look, if you go pay your 15 cents or 25 cents or whatever it is you had to pay to gain admission, you're paying a slave owner to exhibit his slave. And, you know, you consider yourself good Christians and abolitionists. Don't do it. Boycott the exhibit. So Barnum, thinking fast, arranged to have a quote autobiography of Joice Heth drawn up and distributed around in some of these very same churches where the ministers were railing against him. And the autobiography claimed that, you know, not only was she not a slave, that Barnum had liberated her, and that the proceeds from the from the exhibit. Any money that he made from displaying her, we're going to go to free her great-great-grandchildren who are still enslaved. So he turned it around and made it, you know, appear to be an abolitionist display. And as he reports it, you know, people came thronging back to the exhibit, and it was more popular than ever. Now, you had mentioned earlier Frederick Douglass and Sojourner Truth and Jerina Lee and some of the other African-American abolitionists who were on the circuit, you know, having to fight through this kind of freak show, carnival barker atmosphere that surrounded their performances and, or their lectures and their public appearances. And one other element to that was, you know, whenever an African-American person who had escaped slavery wrote a memoir and published it, this was a very powerful way of furthering the abolitionist cause. But whenever a new slave memoir came out, there was inevitably the charge that it was a fake and that it had been written by a white person and that the slave who, you know, was attached to it was just a front man or front woman. And so you have this kind of ritual. If you read enough of these 19th century slave narratives, you have this ritual on the very front of almost every volume. There's page after page of testimony from white people, usually people of, you know, of good standing whose name would be known, saying, you know, I know this person, and I know that he wrote this. I know that he was capable of writing it. I put my good name, you know, on the line here. And so that whole atmosphere of inauthenticity and, you know, cultivating people's cynicism about any claims made by people of color, you know, to be supporting a worthy cause. I think that's something that Barnum really stoked.
It would, for me, my eyes lit up. That's definitely going to be one of my new reference points when I'm talking about the need for black people to remain suspicious of white people, even when they say that they are against racism, because the evidence has shown they are very good. The white people who believe in and practice white supremacy, they are very skilled at deception, being able to use terms to cause confusion, even to say that they're against racism, slavery in this case. Very skilled at that. Got to maintain that suspicion. I wanted to make sure I'm asking now to make sure that I don't forget. So you're at Emory, Atlanta, Georgia, for folks who are not geographically aware. Just with that term dedication, you are in the land of Gone with the Wind.
Yeah.
And you are a 19th century literary professor. I mean, the land where they worship Margaret Mitchell. And you don't think there's dedication to white supremacy?
Oh, I didn't say that there was no dedication to it. I would just say, oh, there certainly is. I mean, you just got to tune into the recent political debates, you know, for the presidential candidacy to see that people are, you know, there are a lot of folks out there, and by God, you know, I mean, not just in Georgia. I've lived in Massachusetts, Louisiana, California, and you know, there are plenty of open racists who are dedicated to it, and no question. What I was saying was, I don't think a definition of racism is sufficient if you only take into account the people who are dedicated to it. I think there are a lot of people who are its unconscious agents. And I do think there are white people of goodwill. I would like to think of myself as one of them. Whether or not anybody else would put me in that category, that's up to them. I do think there are white people of goodwill. Who would work against it if they could, or if they knew, or if they felt it was sufficiently in their sphere of moral responsibility. And I think there are people who do. But what I'm saying, when I objected to that idea that dedication is what defines racism, I think there's a lot of more subtle stuff where even people who are of goodwill can be a part of it. I'm sure I'm a part of it. I know I'm a part of it. I mean, I can't not be. It's that deep.
Wow, that reminds me.
But I'm not dedicated to it. That's the difference. I'm not dedicated to it. Okay, and so that's all I'm saying.
Given what you've written about P.T. Barnum, I will remain suspicious. Long track record of white people tricking us into thinking that. And I would just say, Dr. Barbara Trepanier, that was who I was going to quote, a white woman. She's a professor at University of Texas, Austin. She's the author of Silent Racism, where she's talking about your quote-unquote well-meaning white people. And what she says, one of the main reasons that we have not solved this problem is thinking that there are some white people who are not racist white supremacists. She asserts, and she's a white person, she asserts and gives the logic, same logic that I have, that just what it means to be a white person in a system of white supremacy is to be a part of that system, a part of that dedication to making sure that white people maintain global dominance over non-white people. And I think you can be conscious, unconscious, and still be dedicated. And I think the evidence shows that mass numbers of white people, when they get this information, hey, this is happening, look at how you got this privilege, look at the history of how you got your house and your parents and blah, 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 they still do not make any effort. So,
you're right. And you're right. I mean, you're right about that.
Cue Gone with the Wind. I would have it playing in the background. Rhett Butler and the whole nine. Okay. And I also wanted to ask, since we're being truthful, I think it would have been a lot more revealing. Like, unless I missed it, if maybe I did a poor job reading. Did you include in the book the influencing factors, the O.J. Simpson trial and Clarence Thomas and Rodney King being beaten and then the trial? Did you include that, and what influenced you writing?
I didn't, and there were two reasons. One was I wasn't fully conscious of it. I think, that's something that's easier for me to see 10 years later now that I've written the book. It's been out there for a while, and I see those lines more clearly than I did at the time. I mean, I was certainly aware, and I remember a letter I wrote to a friend as the OJ car chase was, going on in a bar. I was watching it in a bar in Kentucky, where I had gone on a trip to try to find evidence about who Joice Heth really was and where she came from before she ever came into the clutches of Barnum. And I remember writing a letter to a friend. This was, kind of early days of internet, and a lot of people were still actually writing letters, and saying, I feel like I'm watching, P.T. Barnum world all over again. And so I was definitely beginning to make those kinds of connections. So for one thing, it was somewhat below my consciousness as I was writing this. And the second thing I would say is, and this is just my feelings as a writer, I wanted to let those connections be made by readers. I wanted to feel like I was being faithful to the story that I was telling and not trying to wrench it too much into the present. But the more I talk to people about the book, the more I see that people really want to draw those kinds of connections. As we move on, 15, 20 years from now, maybe people will make other kinds of connections to it. But I feel like that would have been intrusive. It's a book about the origins of something, but I didn't want to be too explicit about the present moment.
I'm glad at least we touched on it on the program, Context of White Supremacy. This, again, I keep saying it just because it's my opinion. The people who are not conscious about racism, white supremacy, and making these connections, I've concluded it's unfortunately the victims who don't understand this, and I think if that were true, if non-white people, black people, really had a thorough understanding of racism, we would have corrected this problem, wouldn't be talking about this anymore. This is on page 206, at least of my edition, I think the 2010 version. We are talking about H.A. Saxon. He's written a biography on P.T. Barnum, and I'm going to read this for our listeners and then get you to share your thoughts. In my opinion, it further demonstrates that dedication and what I see white people minimizing racism, white supremacy. This is 206, where you write that H.A. Saxon, in his monumental 1989 biography, examines issues of race, power, and manipulation more forthrightly than any previous biographer of Barnum. But he does so mainly to foreclose any possibility of harsh judgment against the showman. After writing of Barnum's purchase of and disciplinary actions against slaves, Saxon writes, "Let us be candid and have done with it. Barnum's opinion of blacks during the pre-Civil War era was no higher than that of most of his countrymen, whether Southerners or Northerners. As in Barnum's own self-portraits, the showman's regrettable actions are simply a product of the times or are beyond his control, whereas all of his more agreeable features are innovations. Absent is the possibility that Barnum innovated in racism, as in so much else. As for Heth, Saxon concludes that Barnum did not own her, as previous commentators assumed. Instead, he argues, that Barnum had purchased from Lindsay and Lindsay from Bowling merely the right to exhibit her, thus absolving Barnum from the most grievous charge of exploiting Heth. He quotes some of Barnum's early sadistic writing about Heth, but these, for Saxon, are merely youthful bravado. The real relationship between the two was unfailingly chummy, one professional humbug to another. With a profound disregard for the social circumstances facing blacks in the antebellum free North, Saxon writes, one suspects old Joice would have felt right at home in Connecticut. And after giving the main outlines of the Heth tour, including the most thorough account yet of Heth's autopsy, Saxon writes, let there be no crocodile tears shed over the fate of Joice Heth. Her managers appear to have treated her decently enough, and for months she had been at the center of public attention, basking in her role of Washington's nurse. Saxon's manifest uneasiness in handling this material, let us be candid and have done with it, and then let there be no crocodile tears, in an otherwise clear-headed and judicious book, was one of my first clues, that something was still bubbling beneath the surface of the story. I wanted to get you to elaborate on that because last program, we just had a listener who said he is very suspicious anytime that someone says, let me be truthful, let me be honest, let's be candid. He says he gets very suspicious. Can you talk about this tendency to try to paint Barnum as something other than a racist?
Yeah, well, so this was Barnum's biographer, and I hate to pick on, one other scholar, but I found it a pretty egregious kind of treatment, where he's talking about, this was a case of sort of identifying with his subject and wanting to make him into a great man, right? And just completely sliding over anything that was troubling about his legacy. You know, people do this with Thomas Jefferson, coming back to him again, trying to explain away his slave owning, to explain away his relationship with Sally Hemings, to explain away his hypocrisy. And just say, well, that was the times. That's how it was, and let's just get it all out there, and then let's move on. Well, my point was, okay, let's get it all out there, and let's not move on. let's kind of re-examine and ask, really, what was this about? What were the racial dynamics about? What was happening here? What does it mean that the most famous American of the 19th century, the guy who's on the animal crackers box, the guy whose circus still comes to town, you know, the guy who has this image of being America's kind of kindly uncle of, you know, entertainment, who brought the circus to town and, you know, put a smile on every face, all that kind of stuff. What does it mean that he started his career by cutting up a black woman in public? I mean, you know, what does that mean? Let's start there. And so that sort of like, well, let's put it all out there and kind of be done with it. That to me was the problem. And that's where I found this subject to be, you know, something that I could make a book out of, something that really would open up a whole, you know, set of windows onto the past. And it also, you know, and it really made me think as I was reading this biography, well, what about Joice? What about the woman herself? Who was she? You know, let's be candid about it. He says, you know, she would have enjoyed herself in old Connecticut. You know, what a bunch of baloney. But who was she really? And, you know, and that was the kind of hardest part of the book to research and to write. But I tried to at least come up with a plausible story about it in the last chapter of the book.
Wow. I appreciate the honesty. I'm just terms as a doctorate, holding a doctorate in English terms. I would pick that metaphor, what a bunch of baloney. I would say, what an illustration of the dedication to white supremacy, where, I mean, that is, I mean, I can't even say absurd. That is just racist to sit there and tell a bold-faced lie like that a black person would have been right at home in really anywhere in this area of the world in 19th century. I mean, even if you are a free black, quote-unquote free black person in the North, that is not an easy ride. In the 1800s, you could easily be stolen and taken down south, anything. And just staying in the North as though there's no racism there. The race riots that are happening in New York and other so-called northern cities, that is, I can
say.
Yeah,
that was one of the kind of intriguing contexts for this story. We talked about minstrel shows. We talked about the long legacy of, freak shows and human zoos exhibiting non-white peoples to white paying audiences. The other context for this was the race riots and the riots over abolition that were taking place in the very cities, sometimes, you know, separated only by a week or two from when Joice Heth and P.T. Barnum came to town, where you'd have, you know, an abolitionist getting up and making a speech and people trying to, you know, tie him up and drag him across town behind a horse, or you'd have, black neighborhoods set aflame, or black people lynched on the streets. You know, we think about lynching as a Southern issue. You talk about Georgia as, you know, being the land of Margaret Mitchell. Well, let me tell you, New York and Boston in the 1830s, and you know, in some ways still these days, I don't know that you could say it's so much better. But so you
have to convince me.
Yeah, I don't know how you feel about it out there in Seattle, but certainly racial tensions ride as high in these, and did back then. In some ways, they were even higher in northern cities than they were in southern cities, because you had large concentrations of free black folks sometimes competing for jobs with white laborers. And, you know, white people think, this is my birthright, you know, my whiteness. That means I get to be on top. How dare these insolent, you know, black folks, some of the same feelings directed toward Irish, although that's a complicated story later in the century toward Jews, different but, you know, similar. How dare these people come in here and say they're going to vote, they're going to, you know, take our jobs. Next thing, they're going to take our women. And, you know, so there are these riots breaking out all over. That summer was the summer of riots. And, you know, and Barnum taking Joice across some of these very same minefields. And yeah, and for that biographer to say, you know, oh, she would have felt right at home in old Connecticut. That is, I mean, that's about as close to an overt supremacist reading as you could give of this story, as I can imagine.
In my opinion, as a victim of white supremacy, it can't be anything but that. I mean, really. I also wanted to point out, this is on page 204, and you talk about other folks who are referencing Joice Heth. This is Mark Twain, one of my folks I thoroughly enjoy discussing now that I'm a little less confused about white supremacy. This is on 204 of my edition. And you write, it's kind of at the bottom of the page for my edition on 204. Let's see, lost my spot. Okay. Mark Twain took an interest in the Heth legend. Not surprisingly, Mark Twain took an interest in the Heth legend in a speech he delivered before the Correspondents' Club in 1868, and which was reprinted in Elizabeth Cady Stanton's journal, The Revolution. He gave a toast to woman whom he claimed to love irrespective of age or color, at declaring that wheresoever you place woman, in whatever position or estate, she is an ornament to that place she occupies and a treasure to the world. He asked his audience to look at Joice Heth. And then for the punchline, you need not look unless you want to. And one last zinger, as a wet nurse, she has no equal among men. I will reserve comment. Your thoughts on this passage from Mark Twain?
Well, so the joke that Twain is making is that, Joice Heth, he is making a pious platitude about women, that he loves all women irrespective of age or color, and he is, the joke that he's making to the audience is, well, of course there are certain women who obviously one couldn't or wouldn't love, and let's hold up Joice Heth. She becomes this sort of icon for him, and to the extent that people laughed, she served as in this way for them as well, of, you know, sort of disgustingness. You know, therefore, you need not look if you don't want to. So he's resuscitating her memory. This speech was probably given some 60 years after her death, but it was a story that was still well known. He's resuscitating the story in a way to perpetuate that, in a way, I would say, kind of necrophiliac aggression and desire that you were referencing earlier.
Do we see that same contempt for the gender of black people in comparing her as a wet nurse to other men?
Yeah, well, that does go back, doesn't it, to the sort of gender confusion that whenever there's a black woman in public, there must be something wrong. You know, there must be some disguise. And I think also he's holding her up as a sexual object, and at the same time, by calling her a man, he's kind of helping white people defend themselves against that feeling. Maybe that's what's going on below the surface. It's a little hard to tell what's on his mind when he's doing this.
I feel redundant on dedication to white supremacy. When I first saw this, this is my first time learning about this. It reminded me not only of the treatment of Michelle Obama, where that same contempt for gender, where they had a report, she just did a pretty lengthy interview segment last week with Gayle King, where she was talking about being tired. I think that was the word she used. She was tired of being categorized as this angry black female. And I think the comments that I shared from the representative in Wisconsin before, I think that same contempt for gender, where her femininity is degraded, lessened because she's a black female, that passage from Twain, it also reminded me of black people being the butt of racist white supremacist jokes, which is, yeah. In my opinion, that's Huckleberry Finn. Every page dripping with the treatment of Nigger Jim in Huck Finn.
Well, I do have to make one small correction there, and okay. That is that Twain never refers to him as Nigger Jim. There are plenty of critics who do that, but he never uses that term. And I think Jim is, you know, you and I may differ on this, but I think Jim is an incredibly complicated figure because he is turned into the butt of a joke, but he's also the strongest, most interesting character with the kind of, you know, the most moral authority in that book. And I think what that book, you know, is evidence of is a kind of irreducible split feeling that Twain had toward African Americans. And part of it, you know, what made him a good writer is that he really did recognize the humanity of his characters, including Jim. And he, maybe almost in spite of himself, in a sense, really fleshed him out as a human being. Jim's a tremendously fascinating and complex character with a sort of deep psychology and navigates all kinds of situations very complexly. But at the end, Twain turns him into a joke. He almost can't resist himself. So here I think you have somebody skirting up against the edge of his own racism and peering maybe over the edge of it a little bit towards something else, but finally crawling back into it because it's what's comfortable.
Being racist, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. I could be incorrect. I would say, number one, I want to ask the Nigger Jim aspect. Now, you say he does not reference him as Nigger Jim ever?
No.
Twain?
He's occasionally he's referred to as the nigger. And I you know, I hate to use the word in a public context, but it is that's a word he uses to reference Jim. He's never referred to as Nigger Jim in the book, but he's often referred to that way by critics. Tells you more about the critics than about Twain.
Wow. Now that is interesting. The word nigger is used liberally in the book.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Just not, okay. I would say, and I even thought if I had more time, I maybe would have went and reread Huck Finn to pick out some of the
I'm pretty sure on that one. It's been a while since I've read it. But I recently read an article that pointed that out. So I'm next time I read it, I'm going to look for that.
Oh, okay. I wasn't even referencing the Nigger Jim. Like,
right.
It's the word is in there more than 200 times. I really, that's nothing to quibble over whether he calls him Nigger Jim, in my opinion. What I was going to point out, though, I feel like that, again, also interesting terms used to describe Twain's skirting up against his own racism. In my opinion, it's there from the very beginning. There's so many jokes throughout where they put something in his food and almost mash his teeth out, where Huck comes and he pretends to be a ghost of some sort and scares him half to death, and Jim even gets upset about this, and they play it so that Huck has some sort of remorse about this. He feels bad for tricking Jim. It's just even the whole of the story, they get to the end and they do all this, they put him through
clearly, yeah, absolutely. I mean, and, you know, but part of the story is that something else emerges, which is that Jim makes a set of choices that, in a way, both protect Huck and also protect himself in very shrewd and canny ways. So he gives Jim a little more intelligence than certainly the white characters in the book do. I don't have any great stake in defending Twain's reputation. There's certainly plenty of racism and plenty of fodder to make people angry, and rightly so, at the depiction, at the language, etc. Nonetheless, I think there is a something else in the book which he never quite fully, you know, engages in, but that, as I said, I feel like it's him sort of peering out and seeing it, which is that he's writing about a human being.
Wow. I would, and I'm a black person, so I would have to say this is, if this is a white person's effort to not be racist and to not show their dedication, and as you say, they end up having to retreat to being racist at the end because that feels more comfortable, that goes a long way to illustrating why I say that white people are dedicated to maintaining racism, white supremacy, that is just the way that they are comfortable, that is most comfortable for them to just go ahead and practice racism. I would just, anyone out there, read Huckleberry Finn, come to your own conclusions. I did want to ask, I see Justice, I think she might have some questions. I did want to ask, are you familiar with Complexions, Mark Twain's piece?
No, I'm not.
Oh my gosh, I will, it's like a paragraph, I will find it. It goes to the issue that we talked about earlier about if white people have a love or envy for black people. I'll find it while I get Justice. Justice, if you have some questions you would like to ask Dr. Reiss, your mind should be open.
Can I be heard?
Yeah, hi.
Hi. Why do you study of what happened in the 19th century?
Why do I study what happened in the 19th century? Well, you know, that's a good question. I mean, I came to it because I was really interested in the literature and in the social issues that got, you know, that were played out in the literature. But I think, you know, one of the things I try to impress upon students is that, you know, we live in a world where we're constantly bombarded by images and by, you know, new stories and novelties and new gadgets and so on. And but we also live in a world where it's very easy to forget that anything happened before yesterday. And I think if you want to understand why the world is as it is today, you have to go back. And in terms of race and racial history, this is crucial for forming the world that we inhabit. I mean, you've got the birth of scientific racism, you've got the origins of the culture industry that, you know, purveys racist imagery. You've also got toward the end of the century some of the origins of cultural styles within African American community that would go on to be so powerful through the 20th and 21st century. So you've got, you know, cakewalks and the birth of ragtime and so on. So I think it's, you know, that's a period of American literary history that can tell us a lot. American literary history, social history, political history, history of race relations and other things that can tell us a lot about how we got to where we are today.
Why are your strong interests medicine, race, disability, popular culture, and environmental issues?
Why are those my interests? Boy, I don't know. In terms of race and I mean, I think a lot of them grew out of writing this book, to be honest. I mean, my interest in racial culture and racial studies has a lot to do with my own education, my own background. I went to Oberlin College in Ohio, which was the first college that was open to the first primarily white college that was open to African American students back in the 1830s, and there was a strong sense of commitment to social justice there. And went to graduate school in Berkeley, which also has a very strong, proud tradition of you know, activism and social you know, social protest movements, many of them having to do with racial issues. And so it was very much in the air that I breathed, in the classes that I was taking. And the more I learned about it, the more I felt like this was a kind of foundational issue for the country that we live in. And I wanted to go deeper. The interest in medicine and disability really grew out of my studying this particular episode. I saw in the packaging of entertainment here ways in which medicine and disability were related to issues of race, and I've since followed those out in separate strands. So I don't know if that fully answers your question, but that's
that's fine. What does the title mean? What is the title, The Showman and the Slave, Race, Death, and Memory in Barnum's America? And why did you write that book?
Well, okay, so the title, the Showman and the Slave, the Showman is Barnum and the slave is Joice Heth, who was, I think, legally enslaved to him during the time that she was performing for him. I wanted to capture both the idea of spectacle and entertainment and degradation and objectification in those two words. So race, we've been talking about that the whole time, and I think that's self-explanatory in the context of this book. Race, Death, and Memory in Barnum's America. Death, we talked about the way in which this exhibit and so many like it kind of inexorably led to the death of the person who was being displayed, and the kind of cultural fascination with dead bodies and with particularly ideas of race as they were associated with death. The memory part was is a little bit more complicated. Memory. Part of what was being exhibited in this episode was a story about the past, and Joice Heth's supposed memories of this early national history that white people held so dear to themselves. And so I was playing around with the idea of memory being a key concept that was structuring this, you know, this cultural moment. But then I was also interested in how we might remember this past, and why might we choose to look back on it and not forget it. I think that gets at all of the terms there.
I'm actually in a busy area right now. So.
Okay. Well, thank you for
your question. I can ask my questions later, but, you know.
No problem.
Yeah. All right, thanks.
Sure.
I was able to locate the essay, Complexion, that Mark Twain authored. I wanted to share that, and this goes in with a question someone asked in the chat room. We have about 5 minutes left, so folks, if you're listening in and you have questions, hand up now, not waiting until the last minute, get your hand up. The essay that Twain authored, Complexions, he writes, "Nearly all black and brown skins are beautiful, but a beautiful white skin is rare. Where dark complexions are masked, they make the whites look bleached out, unwholesome, and sometimes, frankly, ghastly. I could notice this as a boy, down south in the slavery days before the war. The splendid black satin skin of the South African Zulus of Durban seemed to me to convey very close to perfection. The white man's complexion makes no concealments. It can't. It seemed to have been designed as a catch-all for everything that can damage it. Ladies have to paint it and powder it and cosmetic it and diet it with arsenic and enamel it and be always enticing it and persuading it and pestering it and fussing at it to make it beautiful. And they do not succeed. But these efforts show what they think of the natural complexion as disturbed. As wow. Disturbed, it needs these helps. The complexion which they try to counterfeit is one which nature restricts to the few, to the very few. To 99 persons, she gives a bad complexion. To the 100th, a good one. The 100th can keep it how long? 10 years, perhaps. The advantage is with the Zulu, I think. He starts with a beautiful complexion, and it will last him through. And as for the Indian, brown, firm, smooth, blemishless, pleasant, and restful to the eye, afraid of no color, harmonizing with all colors and adding a grace to them all, I think there is no sort of chance for the average white complexion against that rich and perfect tint. This is from Following the Equator, Mark Twain. Your thoughts on that passage?
Wow, I'm going to have to check that one out. That's some passage. I mean, that's about sort of the unbearableness of whiteness in a way, right? I mean, the idea that, you know, we hold up this ideal of beauty and it's, what was the language that it's empty, or what was the language in there that it needs to mask itself. It's kind of afraid of itself, that there's no good white complexion. I mean, basically 99 white people in the whole world have good complexion. There's a profound unease about whiteness that I think pervades that. But then again, it's also, it's kind of fetishizing blackness, isn't it? In a very weird way, to say that the sable skin is perfection. It's a different kind of othering than the kind he did in writing about Joice Heth as unspeakable ugliness. Let us not speak about it. But let us not look. But it's I would say kind of the flip side of that. What do you make of it?
That fetishization of black people, non-white people, I think this is probably one of the best articulations of that I've seen, just being very clear and very explicit about it. I think it's what we've been talking about in some form or another, I think, for the bulk of this program. It reminds me of... It reminds me of what is not said with regards to why minstrel shows are so popular, why many white people have a fascination with sun tanning, and even the comment that I heard in the coffee shop, this was the last program, Jeffrey Dahmer and what he was doing, it reminds me of so much, but the comment that I heard in the coffee shop this week, it was a white woman, I think, and she was eating chocolate muffins. Well, it was a group of them. They were white women. They were eating chocolate muffins. And they took a bite, and the one white woman, she said, "Oh, I'm disappointed. This isn't as good as I thought it was going to be. I was expecting this to be orgasmic chocolate." And she stopped, and she looked around because she was in public, and she was like, "Oh." And then she went back to eating her disappointing muffin. I think it is that same phenomenon, the racist, Strom Thurmond, it's everything we've been talking about, Strom Thurmond, yeah. Thomas Jefferson, the whole nine.
I think that's right. The undercurrent there is that, the non-white skin signifies sexual availability. It's immediately sexualized.
The envy of dark complexion, see lots of it. Before we wrapped up, a person did ask, did you suggest that white people are envious because they thought slaves were free? That was the question.
That's the paradox. And what I mean by free was that that because they had no stake in social order, that they didn't have to act as if they did. And so it's the freedom of the rebel. And that's what I think was fetishized, was black anger and black permissiveness, black outsiderness. It's the envy for the outcast. And I think there's still, you know, we've still got some of that in our culture where, you know, you have rich white kids, you know, looking at gangster rap and striking the pose because somehow they think that's freedom. You know, when of course that comes from the most unfree kind of space in the country, you know, the inner city, impoverished African-American community where, you know, sometimes the only way out is through the, you know, the gangsta pose. And even that can be a death trap. So, you know, I think minstrelsy kind of stands at the start of that. And that's what I mean. Not that they literally thought that the slaves were free, but that there was something about the culture and the performance that to them was liberating because it was outside.
Again, the book, The Showman and the Slave, Dr. Benjamin Reiss. I learned quite a bit. As I said, I will be using P.T. Barnum as one of my examples for why you've got to be suspicious, because white people have a long track record of pretending to be against racism, white supremacy, when that is not true at all. Thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm glad you could spend a bit of your time with us. And definitely, if you have any more publications or your writings on racism, definitely we'll be keeping an eye out for them.
Well, thanks very much for having me. I enjoyed the conversation very much.
For sure. Professor of English at Emory University in Atlanta, gone with the wind town, Dr. Benjamin Reiss. Have a fantastic evening, and we'll be in touch, sir.
Okay, thanks very much. Take care.
Sir, you too. Context of White Supremacy. We will take a quick commercial break and be right back. Actually, we'll do a commercial and we'll also get in a news report. I posted this on my blog yesterday, but I'm going to play the video that goes with it right now. Racism, white necrophilia, racism, white supremacy through and through. Quick commercial, and then we'll be right back. Context of White Supremacy.
RacismDaily.com, your number one source for global news reports on race, racism, and overt actions of white supremacy. From Asia to the Americas to Europe to Australia to Africa, racism is not a thing of the past. It is our current reality. Be informed. Be globally informed. You should be the first to know. RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of laughing when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? CounterRacism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
Do you need a one-stop shop for all of your multimedia needs? Triumphant Multimedia is a skilled team of professionals with a passion for great marketing and chic design. Our specialties include consulting, brand development, copywriting, and creative graphic design. That's second to none. We also offer photography, photo retouching, videography, and video editing. At Triumphant Multimedia, our goal is to provide highly effective creative solutions built to suit any individual need or budget. Give us a call at 678-732-8067 or check us out online at trimultimedia.com.
Everyone, welcome. This is Justice with the Cows Radio program. If you want to learn about, understand, and counter racism, white supremacy, be sure not to miss a Cows episode. We keep them jammed, packed with constructive information to sharpen your use of words to help eliminate the system of racism, white supremacy, ASAP. Also, to be able to invest in my counter-racist efforts, co-hosting the Cows Radio program, please visit my blog, justdojusticetoday.blogspot.com.
You're just saying just buckets and buckets of words.
Yo, this is Wade, one half of the Black Twins. I want y'all to check something out. Our latest project, Double Consciousness, the Mixed Message. This will be dropping October 2nd, 2011, featuring various audio from Umar Abdullah Johnson and Dr. Ken Baum, just to name a few. You can download this at www.gacmusicroom.bandcamp.com and at stlouismixtapes.com. That's stlmixtapes.com. Replace white supremacy. Supremacy with justice now.
This mixtape is only for victims of racism and white supremacy.
Oh, wow. You just have to give me a moment. The switchboard is not moving. Give me 1 second, and we will get the other sound clip in. I will make sure to get in. We'll be back on Friday of this week. That would be Friday, January the 20th. Joice Heth Gibson, who's on the program last month, Kitabu Publishing. We talked about his book. Ah, there we go. Okay. Everything's good. We talked about his book, Suppressed Rebellion, collection of different quotations about white supremacy, racism. Thoroughly enjoyed having him on the program. He said his favorite book, Trapped in Rainbows, talking about so-called anti-sexual behavior and what is motivating many black people to participate in these activities. He'll be on the program this Friday evening to go into thorough detail about it. Very much that we should all be focused. We just spent a lot of time talking about racist men and racist women's contempt for gender with regards to black people. Continuing onslaught of this behavior. We'll be going into detail about that this Friday, January 20th, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Mr. Joice Heth, the book again, Trapped in Rainbows. Now we will get the other sound clip, black people being victimized even in death.
Paul Stier followed his sister's wishes when he buried Juliet, a Christian, in this Jewish cemetery. She was only 47 and died of lymphoma.
Paul, what did your sister like about this place?
It's nice, peaceful, quiet.
But there's been little peace since Congregation Board Member Maria Balaban did what some consider the unthinkable, suing to get Juliet Stier's remains dug up and moved out.
She's not supposed to be buried there. She's not Jewish. I had no idea what she was.
Paul Stier was flabbergasted when Balaban's lawyer called him.
So what is all this about? Well, my client don't believe your sister accepted the fate, and she has to be exhumed. We're going to take her. I say, man, get out of here. You ain't nobody. You can't do that.
Balaban is also suing her own congregation, even though they say she voted 2 years ago to create an interfaith section.
This, to our right, is the Jewish section. And to our left is the newly opened interfaith section.
But Balaban says this interfaith section was never supposed to include non-Jews without any ties to the congregation.
I would never approve that, and I did not approve it.
Paul Steer is troubled that Balaban hasn't objected to four other plots in the interfaith section. They're reserved by white families.
Well, my sister is black, and the other four that has reserved plot is white.
You think that the woman who is behind this lawsuit is racist?
Well, my belief, yes, I think so.
Are you racist? No, I am not.
Balaban says the other four plots reserved by white families have ties to the Jewish congregation, and that her long track record as a social worker helping black teens speaks for itself.
I do not want to hurt the poor Julia who's buried there, that she thought she was going to be buried in a peaceful place. I'm fighting for those who approve that.
Balaban's fellow board members maintain she knew what she was voting for.
Anybody of any faith could be buried in the interfaith cemetery.
Do you think that Juliet should be moved?
Absolutely not.
The judge will give us justice, and I know my sister will be at peace.
Next month, a judge may decide whether Balaban's religious objections will force Juliet Steer from her final resting place. Susan Candiotti, CNN, Colchester, Connecticut.
No.
Context of White Supremacy. If folks, if you have anything you want to share, things you heard about the broadcast today, or anything else, racism, white supremacy, hands up. I need to prep for Friday's broadcast, get some reading done, all that good stuff. Plus, it's still blizzard weather out here, Pacific Northwest. One thing I definitely wanted to point out, those metaphors, man, just paying attention. Some of the metaphors he used, and this guy is highly refined with regards to his use of language terms at the very beginning of the program, saying that for white people, racism, white supremacy is like surfing. They just ride the wave. Very, in my opinion, revealing metaphor. And then later on, when he was talking about Mark Twain and saying that Twain skirted and got right up to the edge of his own racism, but then retreated because it felt more comfortable, natural for him as a white person to just practice white supremacy. Very revealing, in my opinion. Many of the other things as well. And again, highly let listeners know, for me, I'm able to do a better job listening when I'm not upset. I'm never surprised, angry about these white people. I've already given my... Dr. Trepanier said it best. It's not possible to be white and not be racist. It's not possible. So you should never be surprised. You just pick out, you know, where you think they're using terms to try to be dishonest or to not be as accurate as possible. That's one of the main things when people have asked about how you guard against someone being deceptive. In my view, you make an effort to use the most accurate terms possible. I can give you another moment from the program. I remember when talking about A.H. Saxton, the suspected racist male who wrote this biography, saying that, you know, a black female would have been perfectly comfortable in Connecticut in the 1800s. He said that's a bunch of baloney. No, this is white people representing, illustrating, practicing white supremacy, racism. That's what this is. Not being honest about the world in which we live, being dominated by white supremacy. And that's Dr. Wells, and she just said this weekend, we want to get away from saying that this is crazy, that this is baloney, that all these other terms. We want to use the most accurate terms. And even when I pointed that out, the metaphor he used, calling it baloney for a white person to say all this, he said that it's as close. He used a lot of terms. I'd have to play it back, but it's as close to an overt racist or racialist act as you could come to. Very interesting terminology, not as clear and concise in getting to the root of the matter. Person who called, and I think this might be Blacka. Blacka, did you have any questions, comments you wanted to get in, Blacka?
No, I didn't have a question or a comment, but I do have a story. I was wanting to tell you a while ago, and I wanted to share it with everybody who was listening. And it's not necessarily, it doesn't have anything to do with the program tonight, but it's something that I thought people might want to hear. And understand, this is me. This is nothing that I advise anybody to do. This is how I live. It was a few weeks ago. I think it was before Christmas, maybe after. Anyway, it was I was wanting to get out, but I was also wanting to listen to a audiobook I had just downloaded. So I went ahead and put it on my iPod, and I said I would go up to the park not too far from me, and I would take a few laps and, you know, just listen to the book and just be out in the air for a little while. And it wasn't dark yet, but it was getting dark. And the lights at the park were still on. So I was carrying on, listening to the book. As a matter of fact, I was having a good time with myself. And not really paying too much attention. It was just a few people out. And I hear this truck. You can see the street from the track. And you can see the traffic going past. And I hear this truck, this loud truck, a hillbilly truck when I heard it, is what I thought. And it went past. So, you know, I didn't pay any attention. I just kept on doing what I was doing. And I hear this truck again, but this time it pulls up in the parking lot. And they're doing, you know how they do, carrying on and all that. So I keep walking, and this time they're behind me. So I'm not really paying them too much of attention. And they get out. I can hear them getting out. And they're walking. It's about four or five of them. I would say they were between 19 and 25, I guess. And they start walking my way. So I figure I better turn around and start, you know, walking back in their direction. So I went to behind me. They were all white. And I don't know if they were drunk or what, but they were, you know, carrying on. So they're walking my way. And now I'm walking in their direction. And I'm thinking, you know, they're going to try something for me because I'm the only black person out there. And, you know, they look like they want to have some fun. So the one gets to me before the rest of them. And I guess he was supposed to be the one that throws me off and do it so the rest could do whatever they wanted to do. So he asked me what time it was. And the only way I could tell the time was on my iPod, and it was on my hip. So this time I had taken my headphones off so I could hear exactly what was going on. So he asked me what time it was. I had to raise my jacket up so that I could see my iPod, and I clicked it on. But what I did was, I also, when I go out that way, I always have, and I'm fully trained, I had my 9mm Glock right there also. So when I pulled it up to show him what time it was, he also saw that gun. And that just changed the whole climate, and everybody just calmed down. And then had the nerve to ask me, do I know where to get some weed from?
Wow.
So I look like a victim to them until the tables turn.
Wow. That is fascinating. That is fascinating. What, just based on your observations, why do you think they approached you?
Because I was the only one out there, and it was hardly anyone out. So it would have been like, we could have some fun. There's no witnesses. You do whatever you want to do to this nigga. And, you know, it would have just been a fun old time. We can kick him around or do whatever. We might probably make the news in the morning. But it wasn't going to happen. Not to me.
Wow. Hmm. So you believe this was racist men out looking to do some violent harm to a black person?
Oh, of course. That's all it could have been, because they came directly to me. And in the area that I was in, it's not a lot of black folks out here, but it's some, and they're kind of passive. So, you know, they're trying to, like, you know, they always want to go along to get along, and you know what I mean. Yeah, I just ain't that type, and they didn't realize that, but now they did. But now they do, and we won't have that problem again. Not with them. I won't, anyway.
This is,
and make no mistake about it. If it had came down to me having to pull my weapon, I wasn't going to be the one shedding the blood. You can believe that.
This is war. this is war. And I hope people, the incident that Scotty Reed reported, founder of the Black Talk Radio Network, where he said these racists were in a vehicle and pulling up, carrying on, as you said, and they thought he was alone. And then when they saw other people were in the vehicle with him, and they, you know, decided to leave them alone. The incident that was reported, the victims who were at the restaurant and were terrorized by the gang of whites that didn't even know each other. They just Voltroned up, just, you know, seeing that they were white and that there was an opportunity to harm black people. And that was, hey, we are on the same page immediately. I hope people are paying attention to these sort of incidents. I think it's going to be an increase in this sort of activity. I want to do a program in the next 7 days just about codifying the best way to deal with these situations. What you just described sounds like codification, expecting this sort of, you know, terroristic behavior from white people and being prepared.
That's right. I refuse to be a victim if I can help it.
Excellent attitude. Excellent. I'll ask, there's another person that called in. I don't know if they have comments on this or not. I'll ask before I open their lineup as well. Would you have been this prepared, right? Would you have, before you became less confused about racism, white supremacy, would you have handled this incident the same, differently?
It would have been different. I wouldn't have had a gun. I would have been down for whatever, but I wouldn't have had a gun. I would have probably been a victim. So, no, I wouldn't be prepared, not like I was the other day, no.
Hmm. Wow. Personally, and it, man, this was right on the heel, in Europe, I won't say the area, but right on the heels of the so-called holiday for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I know there have to be a lot of white people who were riled up and looking to do some countering to the discussions about Dr. King and his legacy and what have you, especially anyone in the Georgia area. I'm sure racists look at that as a day to go out and make sure that they are loud and proud in their dedication to white terrorism. The person that dialed in 5407, your line is open as well. Did you have something to share?
Yes. Well, I guess I'll give a little bit of background information. It has nothing to do with as far as what the other guest just said. But I'll give you some background information. My grandmother called me, and about my grandmother, she is, I would say, very confused. I mean, she has pictures of white Jesus hanging up in the house, and she doesn't like black art. She's in her 60s, and she said back when she was coming up, you know, people were more blatantly racist, and so-called black art was just like black Sambos and ugly black dolls and things like that. So she doesn't have any of that stuff in the house. Still has pictures of white Jesus. Well, she called me yesterday, and she knows I'm, like, really big on, like, race relations, quote-unquote race relations and things like that. And so one of her close friends, who is also in her 60s, has, like, this huge house. I mean, like, the house was, like, appraised at, like, $335,000. I mean, like, umpteenth number of bedrooms, full baths, like, the whole nine. Well, she said an appraiser came to, I guess, appraise the house again in 2012, and they had her classified as white on the paperwork. And she said that it was like, it really stuck out to her because this is one of her best friends is a non-white person. She's black. And so she said that it really stuck out to her that they automatically assumed because she had this nice house that she was white. So my grandmother is the one that opened, entered the door or whatever, and they were like, they looked to her like, I guess she was like the maid, and they're like, is Miss such and such here? And they were like, yeah, and my grandmother told her, yeah. And when they looked for the lady, like, the man, like, kind of swallowed hard, like he couldn't believe she was black or whatever. And so when the appraiser left, my grandmother said, on the paperwork they have you listed as white. And she was like, yeah. She was like, I brought that to their attention before because she said that she went in person to fill out the paperwork, and they still have her classified as white. So that's what my grandmother called me to tell me about. But I thought that was really interesting that they actually have a black person classified as white because of the size of her house. I don't know, but yeah. So my grandmother called to tell me that story, and I just thought that was really, like, weird and not a mistake. Like, they were actually looking for a white person, and she said that she went in to sign the paperwork, so they were fully aware that she was black, like, but they still had her listed as a white woman on the paperwork.
Wow. That is fascinating. I just put it in the chat room. Why is a racial classification, why is that on these forms anyway? Like, what does that have to do
right.
with? Wow. Wow.
Yeah. And she said, like, the man was, like, so shocked, and he even came in, and she was, like, he was, like, taking off his shoes, and the lady was, like, I live in this house. Like, you don't have to take off your shoes. And he was, like, stumbling over his words. Like, he really could not believe that she was, like, a black woman, like, actually, like, living in that house. Like, that was her house. Like, they said he was, like, so shocked. Like, turned red and everything.
Could your grandmother be mistaken as white?
Like, no. No, and it's not my grandmother's house. It's her friend's. And neither one of them, they're, like, dark-skinned people. There's okay. no mistake at all. No.
Do you know if the value of the house dropped at all after they found out she was black?
Do I know what? Sorry.
If the value of the house dropped at all after they found out that the owner was black?
My grandmother actually said that they did the gut, like, I want to say she said, maybe like $25,000. And she said the owner of the house said that it was because she was black. But my grandmother, again, I feel like she's very confused. She said that she doesn't think it was because she was black. She think it was because the lady didn't have ceramic tile on her countertops or something.
Yeah.
But I don't know. But I don't know. Something about ceramic tile, my grandmother says. But as I say, she's very confused, still has white Jesus pictures up, doesn't like black art. Anytime she gets anything that looks remotely black, she gives it to me. So, I mean... Yeah, but she did call to tell me this story, and I was, like, shocked myself. Like, classified as white? Like, seriously? But, yeah.
If you don't mind me asking, what part of the country is this?
Oh, well, I live in North Carolina now. My family is from Tennessee, so this was in Tennessee.
Okay.
Yes.
What was the differential, again, in the value of the house once she was reclassified as black?
Like, basically, she just lost $25,000. So, $335,000 house, it went down to, what,
$310,000?
$25,000. So, still, like, $25,000. And my grandmother says it's because she doesn't have ceramic tile, or, what are, I don't, marble counters and ceramic tile in her bathroom. Or, I don't know, something about ceramic tile, my grandmother said. She said she had talked to... like a person who does that type of stuff, and they said ceramic tile is like really important, and it can mess up the value of your house. And I'm like, okay, Granny, like ceramic tile, really $25,000? But yeah. And this house was like nice. Like I went in there and I was like taking pictures. Like I mean, the lady has black art everywhere. Like there's not a piece of white art in this house. And I'm telling you, it's like I've never seen a house so big. Like seriously. And for me, like, I honestly was shocked. I'm not even going to lie. I was shocked when I walked in. I'm like, because you never, like, expect it. And not even from our people, just period. Like, this house was, like, really nice. I was in there taking pictures and everything. But, yeah.
Wow. I'm just throwing this out for folks in general. You all that are on the line can, you know, share your thoughts. Under a system of white supremacy, in filling out those forms, given that you just heard the differential, $25,000, would you go ahead and fill out that form and say that you're white? And or if that sort of error is made and they classify you as a white person, at least on the form, would you leave it?
I would leave it as white. But I thought those questions, you couldn't ask anybody a question like that on those type forms. That's the impression I was under.
I think it's irrelevant, but, you know, it's everything to them, so I'm not surprised.
I was thinking it might be interesting to know, like, some of the history of that particular residential area, because it might be in...
I don't know as far as, like, I know the area is, like, she's the only black person in that area at all. It's like a white subdivision, like, she's the only black, non-white person that I've seen ever. Like, we go over there, like, often. Like, when I'm back in Tennessee, that's my grandmother's best friend, so we're over there often. I've never seen another black person in that area.
How do her neighbors treat her? You know?
Yeah. Her neighbors. I mean, I don't know. I've seen them, like, when we pull up and things, they wave, but, I mean, that doesn't really say much. I mean, I don't know. As far as personally, if they speak or, I don't know.
Okay.
But, again, she's in her 60s as well, so. Yeah.
I was wondering that. I was thinking, because white people, they have a long history of, they know the codes, like which areas are not supposed to have any black residents or not supposed to have right. non-white residents. Like, they might have known the history of that area and like, oh, it's not supposed to be any niggas over here. And, you know, just bang, white. And then they get there like, oh, this must be, the help just came out. It's got to be the help.
Yeah.
I, man, it would be real interesting to do some digging just to see the history of that area, to see, you know, if that's true, if that's just been an area that historically white people have not allowed black people to reside in.
Right. It's I'm from a predominantly white place. It's actually called Johnson City, Tennessee, and this is like Bluff City, Tennessee, which is like the number of non-white people is even smaller than where I'm from. And again, I'm from a predominantly white place, so yeah.
There was one person in the chat room. They said they would not classify themselves as white under any conditions.
Oh no, I wouldn't classify myself as white. But if they made the mistake, you know, I'd let that be on them.
I've thought about doing that as far as the census. I thought about just putting that I was white just to kind of throw them off. But no, I wouldn't classify myself personally as white either.
The person that called in from a block number, did you have any thoughts on this, the housing issue, racism, white supremacy?
Greetings, can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Good to hear from everybody. Make sure I give everyone Black B-More 909.
Yeah, I would leave it as it is if it said white. You know, we don't do the classifying. Let them do the classifying.
Yep. Exactly.
And I was gonna say too, Black. Yeah, man. I was kind of in a situation similar to yours, and maybe we'll talk about it some other time, but I was just wondering, and I guess we'll talk about it, but I just was thinking, this one particular time I remember, it's just, I just feel like no one is half the battle in a certain sense, because, you know, I was in a situation like that, but I was curious to see if what I thought was going to happen, you know, would actually happen. So I didn't let it be known that I was, you know, that I had a weapon on me, and you know, I was outnumbered, and I didn't let it be known that I had a weapon, because I, like, you know, I knew what I was doing. Like you said, you were trained, so I knew I wouldn't have any problem getting the weapon out, you know, quickly. But I just wanted to see if what I thought was going to happen would happen. So I let it go. You know, I had my kind of like my code to how I responded, and just to see, you know, what would happen. So I wonder, like, if people should in certain situations where they feel like they might have, you know, have some power or whatever, should they go ahead and, you know, like in their situation, should we kind of see what's going to happen? Or would that be not good because it could get out of hand? Or because, see, now we don't have no evidence that they attacked you or not, you know, or you know, tried to say something to, you know, get you upset and whatnot. I don't really know. So if you say, yeah, you think that they were, you know, they were going to do something, you know, we don't really know. So I wonder if, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but, you know, and I guess I kind of thought about that, but I didn't want to get that far, because, you know, I just, like I said, on many occasions, I have no patience. And if I wouldn't have, nipped that in the bud, I'd probably be in greater confinement right now.
Excuse me. I feel you. You gotta know yourself. So yeah.
I wasn't gonna kill anybody. Trust me, I wasn't gonna kill anybody. But when it got through, wasn't nobody gonna ever walk without a limp again?
Oh man, I just want us to get to the point where I just want. Man, I don't know. Data. I love data. I'm just kind of person I am. I get the data. But I understand exactly what you're saying.
I understand. My whole thing, I'm just like, and this may be wrong and very uncodified, but I'm at the end of my rope, and I just ain't gonna stand for too much of, I just ain't got it in me to stand for it. And that's just bottom line for me.
I dig it. There's a person that called in 2736. Spirit of Mark Essex.
That's
the person that called in 2736. Did you have comments either on the residential issue or the terrorists, the terrorist situation that Black mentioned, 2736?
Hey, good evening, guys. How you doing? I don't have any comments right now. I posted in the chat room that I wouldn't classify myself as white, but that's very interesting. I've seen where white people classify non-white people as white under some strange circumstances. Yeah, that definitely fits into, I guess, one of the more strange circumstances I've seen. So that's all I had to say about that. But I'll be listening, and I'll speak up if I got something.
Reckless 2.0, D-Train, Vickers, always good to hear from D-Train. As he said repeatedly, gets protection, racist man and racist woman might make it more difficult to get things to protect yourself with. Do so immediately. You're hearing more and more incidents of white terrorism running rampant, as expected in 2012.
Can I ask the female caller a question? Just if you were to say, you know, some words, what's the difference between, from what you've seen, North and South Carolina?
Or you mean Tennessee and North Carolina?
No, North and South Carolina. The differences between those two areas.
I mean, I'm not familiar. I've only been in North Carolina. I moved to Charlotte May 30th, so I've been here almost 8 months, and I'm not really familiar with South Carolina.
Oh, okay.
From Tennessee.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
But I know before I moved here, people are like, oh, that's, you're moving to the plantations. You're moving to the plantations. And I'm like, what do you mean? They're like, it's just, everybody's still living in the slave mentality. And I'm like, okay, that's pretty much everywhere. Like, we're all still victims. Like, I don't know. I don't feel like it's any different from where I mean, there's more non-whites here, but it's still pretty much the same.
Where is South Carolina? That's funny. Wow. I'm thinking of both of those, the incidents, the residential issue, as well as the terrorism incident. I'm just thinking of the best ways of dealing with those incidents. I guess with the terrorism incidents, because that could represent a threat to life.
I mean, weird. Hey, 909.
Am I not being heard? Am I not being heard?
I can hear you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, with the terrorism incident, does anyone have any other thoughts on how the best way of dealing with that situation, or do you think Black is, the way that he dealt with it, do you think that's the best way to go about handling it?
I would say, I don't know how old Black is, but I would just say that I just feel like we need data. And I would just advise, you know, I don't know how old he is, but I would just advise people that are, you know, under 30 or under 35 to be codified and just know your power and just know that we have to do experiments. You have to be prepared, and we have to do experiments because take that data down. I mean, it might already be in, but just for myself, just for my own, you know, my own knowing, that's the kind of things that I do for my own knowing. If I think something or if I have some type of, if I'm recognizing patterns and whatnot, I want to see it through. I want to see if the result is what I thought. But just to have that, just to have that primary, you know, that primary data for myself, and then I would spread it.
909.
Yes, sir.
When you say data, what do you mean data? I think, you know, for that situation, I think I had all I needed to know from that situation. And I am over 35. I'm 45, as a matter of fact.
Oh, okay.
Can you explain data? I also wanted, because there's confusion around the term to be codified. So if you could also explain what you mean when you say be codified, that would be helpful.
Well, codified is for me is getting just doing out of all the things that you could possibly do, you know, trying to do the best thing possible. What would be the absolute best thing possible in that situation? It could be, you know, they say 360 different options. Like, what's the best out of all 360 that I could do in this situation? That's what I mean by being codified. What is the absolute best thing for myself and for non-white, for myself, but sometimes you can extrapolate and say, you know, as far as morality, you're not just by yourself, but yeah, for yourself first. So that's what I mean by being codified.
Well, let me just add, that situation, I think I was very codified because I assessed the situation and I thought about the area that I was in. And I put all those things in line and look at what the outcome was going to be had I take the action that I took, as opposed to taking some different action. I think the action that I took in the area that I was in was the best action that I could have taken, to walk away from there and go back home in one piece and unmolested. And that's what happened. So I think that situation, I was codified. I think I read that whole situation pretty good. Because if the kids had been younger, I wouldn't even have showed them. I was just ignored them and kept on walking.
See, now that's what I would have.
Less of them. If maybe it was two of them, I probably would have just kept walking also. But I wanted them to know that this wasn't going to be no, this playing field is level. You know what I'm saying? I don't want y'all to think y'all going to just come here and just run through me. That ain't going to happen.
I wanted to hear some of the theme. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, 909. I wanted to hear B. Moore's thoughts on how you would deal with this sort of situation as a female. But I did want 909 because I think Blacker asked you to explain what you meant when you say data. I wanted to make sure we got that too.
Simple, just information, bits of information. The more bits or bytes for me, I just the better. So that's all. Just more information. We don't, you know, I think you did the right thing. I mean, you know, you can only assess that for yourself. That's the key. I mean, you know, for yourself, you know yourself. So, So that's no problem. But when you say that you think that they would have attacked you or, and whatnot, I mean, maybe it just, you know, we don't know, you know. And how would, like you said, one of them was a diversion, possibly, you know, to ask you the time. I mean, we've seen that, you know, you got a cigarette and then something happened. You know, that's how, you know, marks get tagged. So,
but see, 909.
Yes, sir.
The reason why you can visualize that situation where that being a diversion and being attacked is because the person being attacked didn't counter the diversion and the attack happened. See, I did that, so I didn't become a statistic or a victim. So in that way, now I don't make the record books because nobody knows about it, and that's where we all need to be. We need to stop it before it happens.
Makes sense.
And you know, another thing, I just ain't nothing to play with. I'm not big and I'm not bad, but you know, like I said, my patience is gone. I have zero patience, and I'm just really, really not a nice person. I'm cordial to people. I'll speak, but you know, if I have to give somebody any kind of leeway, it's not going to happen. Black people are the only ones that I deal with any kind of lenient manner. And by lenient, I mean benefit of the doubt. Outside of that, that's just what time it is.
How many males did you say it was?
It was four or five. I'm thinking it was five of them.
Okay, and Gus asked, how would I handle the situation? As a female, I mean, I really don't know. I would think I would just try not to seem, like, scared or vulnerable, because I feel like, especially white people, they attack people who are vulnerable and who do seem scared. So, I mean, I would just do all I can to not seem as if I was scared or vulnerable, although I would be alone. But, I mean, I wouldn't actually have a weapon to show or anything, so I don't know as far as that.
I mean, like, if you did have a weapon, would you let it be known that you had a weapon, or would you keep that to yourself until you felt like, I mean, would you just make it known?
Oh, yeah. I want it to be the same way this brother said, like, he kind of just was getting his iPod out and it kind of just showed. I would want it to be like that rather than me, like, pull the weapon, because once you pull the weapon, then, again, they're sensing, like, your fear and, like, oh, she's vulnerable, like, she's scared, like, things like that. So I would kind of do it without seeming like I wanted to do it. Like, I don't know. I don't know how it, honestly, I don't know. It's one of those situations, like, you probably have to be in it to really know. But I think that if I was in that situation, I wouldn't try to purposely show it. I would try to act like, you know, I wasn't trying to show it, but show it at the same time. Because I wouldn't want to seem vulnerable or scared.
Ooh, that's interesting. I'm glad, man. I'm glad you told that story, Blacker. And I'm gonna just say it in case anybody is wondering, I keep it under wraps. You know what I'm saying? I like to have, you know, I like to just, I mean, just have, just knowing I've done it so many times. You know what I'm saying? Where people thought they had me, thought that I was vulnerable, talking all kind of mess, not knowing that I was strapped, and you know, I just kept my cool, and I just seen how situations changed. You know, but they didn't know that I was strapped. Never did, and they were coming at me like mad, like animals, like threatening me and this and that and the other, and I just kept my cool and was saying, basically, you know, I don't have no problem with you people, blah blah blah. But they never knew. They never had any idea that I was in a position to, you know, destroy them. And I just found that interesting. But like I said, I understand exactly what you're saying and it sounds it makes sense. So, but I think people should think about that though, and prepare and understand that. Just prepare. Figure out what you want to do, what you want to accomplish, what you're going to do, and you know, try to execute that for your own purposes and for the purposes of others, if that's how you think.
Just curious for Black. We got about 10 minutes left. If folks have anything they want to share, star 8 if you're on the talk show line, star 6 if you're on the free HD line. I was going to ask, as white people generally operate as a... Oh, Black is not on the line anymore. Dang, I'm talking to myself. Well, I was going to ask, the person that called in from a block number, I opened your line. I was just going to throw out, if you have a firearm, white people, generally, they do the Voltron thing, where if they should bump into a nigger that they cannot easily contain, they call in backup, other white people, enforcement officers. In that sort of situation, I was going to ask if he had codified how to deal with enforcement officers. If they come, I know some areas that would be, you need a permit, a concealed weapon permit, and that sort of thing. I was just curious if the codification involved how to deal with enforcement officers if they are called in that sort of situation. The caller from a block number, your line is open, and I'll look up to see if Black joins us again.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Hey, I just wanted to comment on Black's situation from the standpoint of if you do able to carry a legal firearm, you definitely should be aware of whatever, you know, laws that govern that particular area that you're in. And by knowing that, you know, hopefully you wouldn't have to use that weapon. But if you do, of course, when enforcement officials do come, one of the main things to do is to remember, you know, you have a right to remain silent. And the other part of it is to know that whatever you say, you're always in fear for your life. Any action you did with the attempt to stop whatever aggression that you are perceived to be happening. You wasn't trying to kill anybody, you just was trying to stop it. And the reason that you did any type of, action to prevent that incident is because you were afraid for your life. So you didn't want to be harmed, and you did it out of that response. But I definitely recommend anyone that's in a position that has a legal firearm, know what the law is in your particular, area, county, some parts in the South is, legal to carry a weapon. So just know what the law is, and, if you're going to use it, most of the time, my background is as a retired enforcement official. They say you're not supposed to show it unless you're going to use it. So I just wanted to share that.
Man, that was a good, man, good. I appreciated what you said. Just so many, I appreciated what you said right there. And see, what he said is that he's highly trained, and that's the, that's the part I hope people understand, is he's highly trained. I mean, he's familiar with his weapon. He can hold it, and until that, he knows it before he put it. He knows if it's one in the chamber. He knows if it's on safety. He knows how to get it off of safety. He knows his weapon. He knows how many he's in the clip. He said he's highly trained. So if I'm, that's the part that that's the part that I just that's a factor that that I factored in to the whole, you know, scenarios. Like, you highly trained. I mean, you know what you're doing. So, you know, it was not like he's gonna would have been fumbling to get his weapon out. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's just interesting.
Visit the gun range, victims. Visit the gun range. White people make regular treks there. We should be doing the same. This is war, terrorism against black people. Visit the gun range.
Yeah, definitely learn to be proficient with that firearm. And if you have family members, wives, children, you know, take them to the range with you. Most range will allow your child to go, I think, believe if they're 16 and older. But you definitely want to train them. You want to be proficient. We have, as they say, a legal right to bear arms in most of these so-called United States. So just definitely be proficient with it. Definitely be proficient with it.
You said it's a blizzard out there. Oh, Gus, I wanted to say I didn't have access to the internet, but when he said that white people ride the waves of slavery, man, I wanted to be in the chat room because I was going to put cowabunga. That's what I would have wanted to put there. I that comment, man, definitely was one of those comments that what do you call it? It's just metaphor or whatever. Like, wow, that was very interesting and something that I remembered. And I would have commented on that. I would have wrote something in the chat room if I had the opportunity. That was very interesting. You know, I have surfed before, and I've, you know, been on islands, and so I mean, I don't know if people understand that, but I mean, when you're riding the wave, I mean, you're not doing much. The wave is doing all the work, so it's not like you you bodyboarding. You feel me? It's like, wow, is that easy? Okay, I hear you. Riding the wave, okay.
Easy and fun.
Easy and fun, that's right. Oh, don't forget about that part. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's fun. Exactly. Wow. It was so much in that I don't think that was a metaphor, but it was so much in that what he said right there.
I guess he said like, so technically that would be a simile, but same thing.
Right.
That's just a form of a metaphor.
Was that in his book?
No. He said,
oh.
That was in response to dedication. With major pattern, white people responding to that definition and getting stuck on that word, dedication. And in my view, then they proceed to give either directly or indirectly, intentionally or most of the time unintentionally, give 2 hours of evidence of white people's dedication to white supremacy.
Right.
Other California caller, your line should be open.
Yeah, hello. I was just having a chat with my bro earlier today about racism, white supremacy, and I was just kind of thinking he was saying how, like, you know, I was talking about the crest theory, you know, and saying how, like, it's like a dynamic that, you know, that operates, you know, like just from person to person around the whole world. Every person is within the dynamic, and he was saying that it's like, well, like most of them are unconscious of it, So I was thinking how, like, you know, like, you're not conscious of your heart beating, you know, you're not conscious of, like, you know, most things that are happening with you, like, even, like, when you want to scratch yourself, when you feel an itch, you're not conscious of your hand reaching out to the itch, but, like, you know that it's happening, but you're not conscious of it, you know. But I just thought that was an interesting thought.
I'm going to see if I can tinker with that. Your heart, I think that's a great way of explaining racism, white supremacy, and white people's dedication to it. I don't think, as you said, I don't think people go around consciously thinking, you know, my heart, oh, got to make sure it's beating. Let me check, make sure. I don't think that's the case, but certainly, you know, it is integral to you remaining alive. And as soon as there is a problem with your heart, when it's not functioning correctly, generally speaking, you know it immediately. You recognize that there's a problem, a definite problem in your ability to live. And I think it's the same with white people. They demonstrate their dedication to white supremacy when that heartbeat looks like their niggers are losing control, or they're losing control of their niggers. They address the problem. They look for a remedy immediately. Excellent biological metaphor, way of explaining white supremacy, I think. See if I can tinker with that. Thank you for sharing that, sir.
Yeah, I like that, too.
Oh, very well. Like.
All righty. Unless anybody has anything they want to share, we're at the three-hour mark. I do want to get the prayer out because we've been... I have neglected to make time for that. If anything anyone wants to share, last 60 seconds, feel free. Also, if anybody would like to do the prayer to close us out, you can let me know that as well. Everybody's good? Double checking? Nothing to share? Alrighty, we'll be back on Friday, Trapped in Rainbows, Joseph Gibson be joining us his second time on the program, dealing with the anti-sexual campaign against black people, why a lot of us in our confusion, contempt for gender, we talked about that a lot this program, a lot of us are participating in this misbehavior. Thorough analysis. Mr. Gibson, he shared on the last program that his mother is so-called gay. So very much looking forward to having him back on the program. He said this is his favorite book. So Trapped in Rainbows, Joseph Gibson, Black Male, this Friday, January 20th. Program time will be 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Thanks to everyone who dialed in. I will do the prayer since we didn't have volunteers. I'm sharing this is from a loyal listener, non-white female. To our unborn, lend us your spirit so that we may continue the fight. You're the future. To our ancestors, lend us your spirit so that we may bring justice to beings that deceived you. To our Mother Earth, lend us your spirit so that we may remove this cancer that is killing you. To our Father Son, lend us your spirit so that we may cast the light of justice upon this world. Replace white domination with justice immediately. Amen for sure. We'll be back this Friday. Thanks everybody for tuning into the program. Context of White Supremacy, signing out. We'll be back Friday. Thank you all.